As you may or may not know, my wife and I just got back from Vegas. It was a great trip. We ate, we drank, we had a blast. But then we got home and looked at the credit card, and I gotta say, it doesn't matter how much fun you're having, $25 for a drink is a ripoff. Frickin' Vegas. I hate getting ripped off, and so do the lads over at Harry's. They spent years watching the razor blade companies rip people off and said, no more! Not all heroes wear capes, my friends, and they want to prove that they're legit by offering you hot dogs a $13 trial set for just $3 at harrys.com/RTG. I've been telling you about them for months, and I'm genuinely proud to have Harry's as a sponsor of this show. I wasn't kidding. The plastic, futuristic-looking crap razors you get at the store are overpriced and they're poor quality. Harry's blades are crisp, clean, and classy. They're the kind of razor you'd expect your grandpa to have on his bathroom counter. And most importantly, they work. Shave after shave, they're so smooth, they're precise. I used to go through the crappy store blades all the time, but Harry's are built to last. And they're not just better quality than the other names, they're more affordable. And they deliver. Just set your schedule, and for as little as $2, new blades, shaving creams, lotions, everything you need, right to your door when you need it. I genuinely cannot think of a reason not to try Harry's. And I'm not just saying this because they're sponsors. They're the best shaving supplies I've ever used. Try them out. And if you're not happy, your shave's on them. And unlike the other subscriptions, they're really easy to cancel if you want to, too, which is a nice bonus. But believe me, you're not going to want to cancel. Getting ripped off isn't funny. Switch to Harry's. Get started with a $13 trial set for just $3 at harrys.com/RTG. That's harrys.com/RTG for a $3 trial set. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Remember the Game. It is my retro gaming podcast where every week a buddy of mine and I sit down and we geek out about the games we played back in the day. My name is Adam Blank. Thank you so much for listening to the show. And this week it is episode 262 and we're back. Sorry about missing the episode last Wednesday. I had some stuff come up here, some tech issues and everything, and I couldn't fit the show in without half-assing it. And I already half-assed this show, so another half-assing means this show has no ass. Shout out to when he gets that reference. And if there's one thing Remember the Game needs to be successful, it's lots of ass. And fortunately, this week I'm back, and I'm using my entire ass to talk about one of the probably universally considered greatest games of all time. Is there anyone out there that just hates this game, unless you hate the genre? It's Final Fantasy VI, also known as Final Fantasy III on the Super Nintendo. The thing I hate the most about talking about this game is this whole conundrum between the numbers. So just in case you are in the dark here, this was the sixth Final Fantasy game, but it was the third Final Fantasy game in the main series to come over to North America. I don't know what it was called in Europe, probably Final Fantasy Crumpet or something. But here in North America, it was Final Fantasy III on the Super Nintendo. It had that purple box. You probably know what I'm talking about. It was technically Final Fantasy VI, which is why, again, here in North America, we went from Final Fantasy I on the NES to Final Fantasy II and III on the Super Nintendo, which were actually 4 and 6, to Final Fantasy VII on the PS1, which was Final Fantasy VII, and et cetera, et cetera. So if you're wondering why we're calling it Final Fantasy VI when you know it as Final Fantasy III, that's why. Or if you know it as Final Fantasy Crumpet, whatever. Anyways. And I'll tell you all right now, we're going to spoil the fuck out of this game. We're going to spoil the fuck out of it. It is old as shit. We're going to spoil it, so you've been warned. And this is going to be a beefy one. This is going to be a big episode, because not only is it a revisited episode, we actually covered Final Fantasy VI way back on Remember the Game number 7, but it's also a stupid sexy sponsored episode. Darth Skywalker, friend of the show, sponsored this episode on Patreon almost a year ago, and we're finally getting to it. And just quickly, I've been getting asked a lot about sponsored episodes. Can I sponsor an episode? When can you sponsor episodes? I just want to make sure everybody knows I actually dropped this tier on Patreon. There's just too much demand, and I just can't keep up with it. We still have 5 in the backlog that are almost a year old. So once those are cleaned up, that is going to be it. I appreciate all the interest, but we're not going to do these anymore. With one exception, I will be auctioning off some sponsored episodes, some chance to appear on the show during my Extra Life charity stream later this year to raise money for the Stollery Children's Hospital. So you'll know more about that when I know more about that. We still haven't set a date for it or anything like that. Anyways, Darth Skywalker sponsored this one, so he swung by to explain why he loves Terra and Celeste and Locke and Saban and Shadow and Edgar and, of course, the GOAT. That son of a bitch, Kefka. Hear that in the JR voice. That, oh, you son of a bitch. And then I figured a Hall of Fame game deserved an almost Hall of Fame worthy guest, as is my pal, Mark McHugh, who makes his Remember the Game return, and we get into what makes this game so great, why it's always near the top of the best Final Fantasy games lists, and why everyone needs to experience Final Fantasy VI at least once. And we get to all that in just a minute, because speaking of things everyone needs to experience at least once, it's time for another edition of the Remember the Game infamous intro. And if you're new to the podcast, welcome aboard, and consider this your warning. Our intros are kind of long, but they're fun, and they're not quite as evil as Kefka. We haven't poisoned any water. We do laugh a lot, but anyways. Also, there's no opera in the infamous intro. I still don't understand the hype around that part of this game, but we'll get into that on the show. Seriously, though, if you do want to skip the intro, you just want Final Fantasy VI chatter, go about 30 minutes up. You should hear the music. We'll be into it. I got to do my plugs. It's how we keep the bills on. Bear with me for 3 or 4 minutes here. We are extending our summer sale. We were running it until the end of August. Now it's going until the end of September. Save 20% on all your Remember the Game merchandise at rememberthegamepodcast.com with code RTG5. We have two new shirts, our 5th anniversary shirt featuring me and our CEO, my beloved dog Molly. And we also have a Saturnian World Order SWO shirt for you Sega Saturn weirdos. So you can check out all of our merch at rememberthegamepodcast.com. It was all designed by my man Joe from 4545creative.com, so thank you to him very much. And of course, if you don't like clothes, I get it. You can always just support us on Patreon. And I need to put this out there, Patreon is finally compatible with Spotify. You can actually look up the Remember the Game Patreon feed on Spotify, even if you're not a Patreon now, and you can't access the episodes, but you can scroll through the entire catalog, see what's on there. And then if you decide to become a Patreon, ba-bam, they all unlock, and you can listen to fucking hundreds. I think there's about 500 Patreon episodes now, right there on Spotify, ad-free, ready to go. We offer 4 extra shows a week, so that number's going to keep getting bigger. Every Monday, we do Purple Monkey Dishwasher. Me and Mark McHugh talk The Simpsons. I love it. Every Tuesday, it's The Rambling Idiot, where I ramble about comedy, TV, movies, sports, whatever I feel like. Every Friday, it's Game Patch, where I talk about all the biggest news in modern video games, sprinkle in some profanity, give you some sales picks, etc. And Expansion Pass goes live every Thursday. To me, that's the golden egg in the basket. It's a different gaming show each week. We look back at characters and consoles. We do tons of rankings. There's comedy episodes. There's a mountain of modern game reviews. This past week, it was Expansion Pass 170. And we ended up doing a two-parter for the first time ever. Expansion Pass 174 and 175 were Play 1, Remake 1, Erase 1 Hot Dog Edition. I went through over 100 of our Patreon submissions for Play 1, Remake 1, Erase 1. I made my picks. A lot of them were very difficult. Every week I get shit from everybody for making Play 1, Remake 1, Erase 1 so hard, and y'all got your revenge this week. Holy Christ. And as is becoming tradition, here is a sneak peek of last week's episode of Expansion Pass, Play 1, Remake 1, Erase 1 Hot Dog Edition. Tim Tiani said Mega Man X, Tetris, and A Link to the Past. Well, I'm playing Tetris. Before I even decide what I'm going to do with Mega Man and Zelda, motherfucked if I'm erasing Tetris. That game is my lifeblood. So I'm playing Tetris. Ooh, which one do you remake? That's my favorite Mega Man game and my favorite Zelda game. Ah. I'll remake Mega Man X and I'll erase Link to the Past. And I have no logic. I have no logic for that. Other than, like, you basically just put two kids on the plank and we're like, you can pull one back, the other one's going to the sharks. And I just grabbed one. Because I'm not going to let them both be erased. But you're fucked, Tim Tiani, to make me choose between those. You're fucked. That's now available on our archives, and this week it's Expansion Pass 176, and as it's the final Expansion Pass of the month, the topic is up to our Patreons. And as of this recording, the poll is still running. It looks like it's either going to be top 10 NES games that need a remake, or the characters I hate the most in gaming. Those are the two that are neck and neck at the top of the poll right now. So, again, subscriptions start at $3 a month. You get new podcasts every week. You can listen to all of them on Spotify in one nice, tight, neat little package of a feed. It's awesome. They're all ad-free waiting for you. You also get access to the Remember the Game Discord, the chance to vote on our Patreon polls every month, the ability to submit comments to be read on our shows. You can DM with me, you get discounts on merch, and you even get a shout-out and get to hear me mispronounce your name like I'm about to do to most of these people. A huge thank you to our newest Patreons, the list of which I don't have up right in front of me. Here it is. A huge thank you to our newest patrons. Mox This. Suck on My Pro Labs. Ugh. Ryan Shy. Justin Arrow Slow Nice. Bearded Bastard from Parts Unknown. Josh Fritz. Amish the Giant. Thavik. Justin Jenkins. Flex Luther. Adam Blank's Pornhub subscription. It's such a waste. Nobody pays for porn. Jerome, except me apparently. Jerome Robkey, Brandon Dudrow, Sean Davis, Occupied Ace, Today on Today, Canadian Made Punk, Muted, Navinix, I think I said that right. Julian Dubois, Jake Yancey, Jordan P, Eric Hopewell, William Vinterscar, that's such a sick name. Andrew Hayden Hedman, Danny Gautier, I hope I said that right. Vicious One and Tyler Lund. Tyler L., thank you all so much for the support, and welcome to Remember the Game Industries. You can find all that at patreon.com/rememberthegame, and don't forget, 5% of our Patreon income gets donated to charity at the Stollery Children's Hospital, and we offer annual subscriptions that will save you your 12th month's fees. And finally, you can find me on Twitch whenever I have time to get on there, twitch.tv/rememberthegame. Come by and say hi, and we'll be friends. It's really cool. That's enough blowing myself. Let's blow some of you by blowing in some cartridges. It is our opening segment on the show. I read a few comments and questions from our patrons, usually gaming related, but not always. And we call this segment Blowing in the Cartridge.
He blows all right. He blows big time.
That's it, honey. Get into the spirit.
Let's blow. Our first blower this week is Evan Azzo, who wrote in and said, "Hey there, Blankarino. I've got a podcast question for you. I notice if you take a bit long..." Holy cow, I suck at this. "Hey there, Blankarino. I've got a podcast question for you. I notice if you take a bit of a longer time during the infamous intro, you speed things up a bit. When theoretically, it's your podcast and it can be as long as you want. Do you always have a set time limit you shoot for? And if so, what is it? And why do you feel it's a good length?" I usually try to come in right around the 30-minute mark and then the music starts. And it's because I tell people off the top, skip ahead 30 minutes. I do get shit from some people that the intro is too long. And someone asked me the other day, why is it called the infamous intro? And I'll be completely honest, it's just there to fuck with people that hate how long it is. When we started doing the longer intro a couple hundred episodes ago, I asked people, "Hey, do you want me to drop this and just get right to the chat?" And it was a very large percentage of our listeners were like, "No, keep the intro as it is. I like the intro." So I've decided to keep it. I honestly could care less. I'll do whatever more my listeners want, but most people have said they want the intro left around. But a couple people get pissed off and feel the need to leave bad reviews. And like, "This idiot talked for so much and blah, blah, blah." So I just, I love those. So I started calling it the infamous intro to fuck with people. The reason I shoot for the 30-minute mark is I feel like it's a round number, and I like to tell people go ahead to about the 30-minute mark. People have asked why I stopped putting timestamps into the description. It's because I never know if we're going to have the ads playing in the ad slots or not. And if they are playing, they change in length and they can change up the timestamp. So it's hard for me to offer those timestamps now. So that's basically, I shoot for 30 minutes. But that, yeah, you're right. I'm in charge. I could fucking go as long as I want. Who gives a shit? Plus, Molly's always waiting. My dog is always waiting to go out for a walk as soon as the show is done. So the longer I go, the more she scratches at my foot. And dogs have little claws. They're like cats. It's fucking weird. Brandon DeZeba said, "Hey, Hot Dog King, I was curious as to how you select the clip you present every week, showcasing last week's Expansion Pass preview. I know you hate listening to the sound of your own voice, but do you re-listen to the entire episode to find the clip, or already know after recording what you want to showcase? Have a super week." Neither. So if you don't know, if you do usually skip the infamous intro, I just did it. As is becoming tradition, here's a sneak peek of last week's episode of Expansion Pass. I usually just fire it up, and then I skip ahead to about 20 minutes when I know that we're into deep discussion, and then I just listen for like a... I try to find like a 1 minute segment that works and I crop it out. I don't listen back to the whole thing. I also don't know in advance, which is why I don't post more clips of the Patreon shows on social media. I should be doing that. But that just requires me listening to it and finding a clip and listening to your own. I'm not going to judge any of you that listen to your own podcasts, but not for me. I would rather push a canker sore up against the back of my teeth than listen to my own fucking podcast. So I just kind of fast forward into it and then find a minute where it kind of cuts off cleanly, and that's good enough. There's no logic here at Remember the Game. Where was I here? Pancake Jesus said, "Hey Adam, with Edge possibly retiring after last night's SmackDown," keep in mind these are a week old, "what's your favorite moment from his career? His 2020 Royal Rumble return was legendary and is easily my favorite." Yeah, I think the 2020 Royal Rumble return has to be number one. That was sick. I'll give an honorable mention to when he cashed in the Money in the Bank to beat Cena at the Elimination Chamber for his first title, because I love seeing him win a world title. But the 2020 Royal Rumble return is that the greatest Royal Rumble surprise entry of all time? It has to be, right? I think it is. Drew Carey's up there, but I think it's probably Edge's return. It was sick. What a career. Yell at me if you want. Edge has surpassed Bret Hart in Canadian wrestling. I don't care. I hate Bret Hart. Y'all know that. If people always ask me, why do you hate Bret Hart? He should have lost to Shawn Michaels. I don't want to hear about it. But to me, it's Jericho and Edge are one and two. And then Bret Hart's probably, like, Bret Hart is on the Mount Rushmore. But I would put Jericho and Edge ahead of him. That's me. Hot take, maybe. Fill up my mouth with farts. Said, "Hey, Adam, you recently got to attend a taping of AEW, which was awesome. I got to attend the taping of SmackDown when it was in Calgary recently. My question is, are there any other wrestling bucket list items for you? Mine would be to attend an actual pay-per-view, preferably one of the big four, Royal Rumble, if I had my choice." Yeah, I've been to an AEW pay-per-view. We went to Double or Nothing in Vegas. It was sick a couple years ago. But I would, the Royal Rumble. The Royal Rumble is number one on my, like, I would love to go to WrestleMania, but Royal Rumble is it. I want to go to a Royal Rumble so badly. You don't even know. It's been a dream of mine since I was like a little kid. And we will. Bet your fucking ass I will be to a Royal Rumble someday. And then fucking somebody shitty will win it. You watch. But yeah, that's number one. Okay, I'm sure some of you are sick of wrestling. We'll get back to other stuff here. Haru of the Takagura Dojo said, "What's up, Mr. B? Curious on what your favorite board game is. Also, have you any interest in the Gloomhaven Switch game? Thank you for all you do." Thank you, Haru. To answer the second question first, probably not on Gloomhaven. I've been asked a lot, like, "Are you interested in Armored Core 6? Are you going to play this? Are you going to play this?" Like, maybe someday. I won't say no, never. But my dance card is full. Like, through the rest of the year, I don't... Like, I'm trying to finish WrestleQuest right now. Starfield comes out on September 6th. And then Starfield, I'm sure, will take me until October 20th with Spider-Man and Mario. That'll take me to Mario RPG. And then I'd still love to try to sneak in Persona 5 Tactica and Sea of Stars. That's already... Like, that's... I'm done. Like, I won't be able to do anything else. Like, that's my dance card for the year. So, and then retro stuff for the show, but so much to play, dude. Us gamers are eating right now. It's sick. Amanda Hug and Kiss said, "Why can't I find Amanda Hug and Kiss? Hello there, you hoser. As a Remember the Game..." I like that. I love being called a hoser. "As a Remember the Game employee and stockholder, I've come to realize how shockingly little I know about our CEO, Molly. We the people demand to know about how you two met, her favorite treats and activities, etc. I'm actually going to dedicate a rambling idiot to talking about my dog someday, but just because I don't know how many people care. Yeah, Molly, my dog, is our CEO. She is a Shih Tzu Poodle Terrier mix. She's 13 years old. She is my best friend. She's laying right here beside me. I love this dog more than anything on this planet. I'd give up the show for 10 more years with my dog. No, like, without even thinking twice about it. As far as how we met, my sister-in-law got her, and then they had something come up, and they'd already had a dog, and they had two babies, and they were like, "Would you guys be interested in this dog?" And I said no, and then we babysat her for a weekend and then just never gave her back. We used to joke there was like a love triangle in our house at one point when we first got Molly, because I liked Shaylee more than Shaylee liked me. Shaylee liked Molly more than Molly liked Shaylee, and Molly followed me everywhere, and I was like, "Leave me alone, I just want to hit on my girlfriend." And so it was like this vicious, now we all just love and hate each other the same. But yeah. And then treats, she can't have any because she's got a fucked up stomach. She almost died when she was young. So now she basically just eats boring food. I don't think she doesn't even know the word treat anymore. She just eats boring food. We'll do an episode all about her someday on The Rambling Idiot. I love that dog. Phantom Owl said, "Hi, Adam. After listening to you for over a year straight now, I have a burning question. What the hell is double secret probation. Is there some penalty attached to this? Like, I lose my firstborn or go to the penalty box for 5 minutes? Is there a single secret probation? Also, what's so secret about it? I can't be the only one wondering. Anyways, thank you for being that distant voice that keeps us all relatively sane on our commutes to work. Be safe. You too, Phantom Al. Thank you for listening. I do get asked this on occasion, so I will just say, I think nobody would expect this coming from me, because I don't know movies, but Double Secret Probation is actually a movie reference. I don't know if it was from something prior to the movie, but National Lampoon's Animal House. I don't know if it's actually a real thing or not, but just Google Double Secret Probation. The clip will come up. Basically, the main character's in Animal House. It's like a fraternity. They get put on Double Secret Probation because they're so bad. And I just kind of said it one day, and then somebody wrote in and said they thought it was double seeker probation, which I thought was even fucking better. So now, for those of you that ask, like, is it double secret or double seeker? Whatever you want. Why is it double? Because it's more important than single. And what is the penalty? Well, you'll find out when you inevitably get put on double seeker probation, just like 9/10 of my listeners have been. You bastards. I just punched my mouse and it fell off my desk. Anyway, that's the long and short story of what double secret probation, double seeker probation is. And finally, before we move on, you know what it is. It's letter time. It's letter time. Bryce Joel wrote in and said, "Hey Adam, since I started gaming again this year, I realized how amazing the Switch is, but I'm so eager to play games on newer consoles like Final Fantasy 16, Alan Wake 2, Spider-Man 2, etc. on the PS5, or Starfield soon on Xbox. What's your opinion on purchasing a new console, with all that shit being so goddamned expensive? If you had to choose one, what would it be? Buy a PS5, an Xbox Series X or S, or be a hardcore Nintendo fan and hold out for the question mark of their new console? I just can't decide if the current gen consoles have games that make it truly worthwhile yet, though you do make Game Pass sound appealing sometimes. Thanks for reading. Love, Bryce." That's a tough question. So we're putting aside any fanboy or fangirl bias here. This isn't like PlayStation's awesome and Xbox is dumb, or people that play PlayStation are ponies and us Xbox kids are the cool. All of you that shit on the other side are idiots. You're all idiots, and you're the worst part of this hobby, and shut the fuck up. That said, if you have to pick one, I'm not saying, you know, you brought up how expensive this stuff is, Bryce, so I'm not trying to throw shade to be like, Bryce can't afford both. I don't know if you can or not, but I'm going to interpret this question as like, hey, I have enough money for one system. Do I buy a PS5? Do I buy a series everything? Or do I wait for the next Nintendo system? If you've got the money, I wouldn't wait for the next Nintendo system, because they still haven't even confirmed when it's coming, and there's every chance they fuck it up and do something stupid. And I don't think we're getting it before next fall at the earliest. So if you've got the cash, I think at this point, the PS5 is worth the next-gen price point. You can play some of those games on PS4, but Spider-Man 2, God of War Ragnarok, I mean, I think Final Fantasy 16 is dope. I've really enjoyed, like, Horizon Forbidden West, Returnal, Deathloop, Ratchet & Clank. I've been very, very... And BS Plus has really turned it around, man. It's a great fucking subscription now. If you didn't have a PS4, you're golden with PS5. You have games out your ass for the next 2 years. So I think a PS5 is worth it 1 million percent. As far as an Xbox Series X or S, I love my Xbox Series X, and I do think Game Pass is rad. But I'm going to be honest, in 3 years, Xbox hasn't done a lot to make their system a must-own. I don't think they've released a lot of exclusive games. Obviously, Starfield is a week away. That might change things. We'll see how Starfield does. I'm excited for it. I can't wait to play it. But they don't have... I mean, dude, like, those listen to the games I just listed off, right? Like, Ratchet & Clank, Horizon, God of War, Spider-Man 2, Demon's Souls, like, Final Fantasy 16. Sony's had a lot of big exclusives. Xbox has had, I mean, Forza, Halo Infinite, Hi-Fi Rush is awesome. Is that it? Like, Redfall, but that didn't really do that well. Like, if you haven't played Xbox since, like, the original, or if you've never played Xbox, yes, an Xbox Series everything is worth it. Because you get Game Pass, and you have all the Gears games, all the Halo games, not to mention all of your, you know, your Elder Scrolls, and your Fallouts, and, like, Dooms, and all this shit is on Game Pass, and is ready to go. But, I guess if I was ranking them, I would say a PS5 if you're indifferent toward what system you buy, I think a PS5 is the better purchase right now. And then if you're new to Xbox, an Xbox Series S is half the price. Get Game Pass and you have lots to play. Or an Xbox Series X. I've been happy with mine, but they have yet to prove that they can keep up with the exclusives we need to justify the cost. I don't feel like they've justified the cost of the Series X yet. I think the PS5 has, and I think the Series S has. So I hope that that helps. If you can only afford one and you just want to play a bunch of games, I would go with the PS5 right now. Call me in 2 weeks when I've played some Starfield and I'll let you know. But as of right now, I think the PS5 has got the better library. And that controller is pretty tight. And PS Plus is fire. Okay, we need to move on. I hope that helped, Bryce. Send me a DM if you want more information. And thank you to everybody that wrote in, as always. We had a ton of comments this week. I bombed through as many as I could. Let's switch things up and get to our Smash It segment, the official game show of Remember the Game Industries. It is Play One, Remake One, Erase One. Yay! And a huge thank you to Classic Concentration from the NES for unknowingly providing us with the theme music for the show. The rules are simple. Every week I give our listeners 3 retro video games. They can play one as it was released, remake one as a modern game, and the third is erased from time forever. And as always, there is no wrong answer, but there is a right one. We'll get there in a minute. This week we're talking Final Fantasy VI, so I went with quite possibly the 3 games that would join it on the SNES RPG Mount Rushmore. You've got Mario RPG, Chrono Trigger, and Earthbound. Man, the Super Nintendo had a lot of RPGs. Holy fuck. Very, very close poll, but 22% of you said you'd play Mario RPG, remake Earthbound, and erase Chrono Trigger. That's crazy, but the 2 runner-ups that tied at 20% both erased Mario RPG. So for those of you that are like, how are they erasing Chrono Trigger? It was close across the board. Let's see what a few of you had to say here, then I'll tell you what the right answer was. We had 140 comments. So I touched a nerve with this one. I'm going to get through 5 or 6 and then wrap this up. Chicken McGangbang said, out for revenge after the recent Patreon episode, eh? Played and beat all 3 of these, but the rules are the rules. I'll play Earthbound. Nothing needs to change in this masterpiece. I'll remake Chrono Trigger in that new pixel art style. Mwah. And I'll erase Mario RPG. I love the humor and the fun, but it was like baby's first RPG. I agree. Like, I love Mario RPG, but I won't disagree with you. I think it is easily the most basic of these 3. And if you like deep RPGs, Mario RPG is the one to erase. I get that. No one is getting stabbed in Toronto tonight. Said, Earthbound looks fun. I'll play it. I'll remake Chrono Trigger, please. I want to try it so bad. Mario RPG? Meh. I don't like my RPGs too complex. Looking at you, Witcher 3, but Mario as an RPG never felt like something that grabbed me. So it's got to go. Yeah, that's fair. And you know, the thing about remaking Chrono Trigger is, like, you don't even have to remake it. Just release it somewhere. Like, just put it on the Switch. I think people would be like, I don't give a fuck if you do anything to it. Just put it on the Switch so we can play it. You sons of bitches. I just bought it on my Steam Deck so I could replay it for an upcoming episode of the show. And I was like, man, it is just not available anywhere. That game is just, it's like they lost the master file to it or something. Dalton Darling said, this is kind of an easy one. The hardest part is figuring out what to play and what to remake. So to start, I'll erase Chrono Trigger as we have enough JRPGs with long, spiky, colorful haired protagonists. Fair point. I'd remake Earthbound as I feel it needs the refresh the most, fix the inventory system and make it less grindy. That inventory system makes me crazy. And that leaves me playing Mario RPG as I've never played it. And from what I've seen, it seems like one of the easiest pickup of play RPGs ever created. It is. And I can't wait for the remake of it because everyone will be able to play it. I promise. Remaster, whatever the fuck it's called. Scrap 104 said all 3 deserve to be played or remade and none should be erased, but rules are rules. Fucking rights. I'll play Mario RPG. It's a great RPG game to play for all ages, newcomers, and RPG veterans alike. I'll remake Chrono Trigger. Deserves some modern love in the style of either Final Fantasy VII Remake, Dragon Quest XI, or Octopath Traveler. Final Fantasy VII Remake Chrono Trigger would be pretty sick. And then erase Earthbound. Aside from Virtual Console and Switch Online releases, Nintendo hasn't been giving any love to that series anyway. Sure, there's Smash Bros, but come on, bring some of that effort to a new game or remake. Agreed. Fuck, agreed. And Ida Hoju said, no matter what you say, Adam, there can't be a right answer to this brutal, heart-wrenching poll, but here we go. Play Mario RPG as I'm literally replaying it already and it's still amazing. Remake Earthbound, though it doesn't need one. Maybe some quality of life fixes could actually help me finish this gem. Sadly, erase Chrono Trigger. I've played it so many times, all 10 endings or however many there are, and it's perfect as it is, so no remake needed. Farewell, sweet Chrono. So brutal. That's what I like. I like to hurt people with this. I personally am going with a runner-up this week, 20% of you, as is Arrow Slow Nice, who said, first-time post for realsies. This is easy. Play Chrono Trigger. It has a Frog Knight. What other game has that? Remake Earthbound because I've heard great things about it and I've only ever played it for maybe maybe an hour, so a new splash of paint would go a long way, and erase Super Mario RPG only because I've never played this, and since they're remaking it, what better way to start than with the new one? That's fair. I'm going with the same order for different reasons. I'm going to play Chrono Trigger because I've only played through it once or twice. I've played through Earthbound and Mario RPG a million times. So I'm going to play Chrono Trigger because I don't know it like the back of my hand. I'm going to remake Earthbound because I want to see it in that Octopath Traveler 2D HD art style. And I'm going to erase Mario RPG because I fucking love it, but I can play it in my head at this point, and I still have Paper Mario. If I erase Chrono Trigger, Earthbound, that's it. I can still go to Paper Mario. So I'm very sorry, Mario RPG. I love you. That's it. Thank you, everybody, for writing in and playing along as always. We're going to go to a quick word from a sponsor, maybe, if I have one. And then we'll be back. I'll tell you what I've been playing, and we'll get into Final Fantasy VI. So here's the word from a sponsor, if I have one, I hope. This show is sponsored by BetterHelp. Everyone that listens to this podcast knows about our illustrious CEO, my dog Molly, but the other silent partner behind the scenes is my wife. And let me tell you, my friends, a 17-year relationship with another person that has to talk to and live with you is a lot harder to maintain than one with a dog. We've had our ups and downs, and as you all know, a relationship isn't all sunshine and rainbows. They can be a lot of work. You get out what you put in when it comes to relationships, and talking to a therapist can be a fantastic way to put in some work. They can help you work through your issues, learn to communicate better, and even just provide you with an ear to bend when you need it. I've talked to my therapist about my relationships, especially when it came to my stand-up comedy career and how much I was away from home, and they helped me work on ways to keep my relationship strong even when I was out on the road. It turned out our relationship was actually better when I was out on the road, but that's a story for another day. And I know, right? Therapy. Who has the time these days? BetterHelp hears you, and they're making it easy. Fill out a quick form online, and they'll match you up with a therapist that suits your needs and that'll work around your schedule. You pick the meet times, and you can get your therapy fix from anywhere, over video, phone, or just chat. Become your own soulmate, whether you're looking for one or not. Visit BetterHelp.com/rememberthegame today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/rememberthegame. Okay, what have I been playing over the last 2 weeks? Because it's been 2 weeks since I did one of these. I've been playing Final Fantasy 16. Finished it. I'm going to review it on next week's expansion pass. I've been playing Final Fantasy 6. We're going to hear what I think about that in about 2 minutes. I've been playing WrestleQuest, the new wrestling indie RPG. It's not hooking me yet, but it's not terrible. I'll review it on Expansion Pass in a couple weeks when I'm done. I need more time with it. I'm not sure yet. I'm also playing the original Silent Hill, which will probably be next week's Remember the Game. And I've started Star Wars Jedi Academy, which will be a Remember the Game coming up in the next few weeks. So far, so good. Lots of games to play. It's good times. I'm feeling good about it. Let's talk Final Fantasy VI, though. That's why you're here. As always, I like to let you nerds sound off about the game we're covering before my guests and I hog the mic. We had a lot of comments this week. I'm going to burn through a bunch of them. Let's go. Clax said, thank you for posting the SNES box art with Final Fantasy III proudly displayed. I played this on the original SNES, and it still stands as the best 2D RPG ever and beats most 3D competition, too. It was groundbreaking and engaging right from the opening, and I can't wait to play it again now that the re-release is out. I still have the original game guide. Hope it still works. I do think this is one of the best RPGs ever. I agree with that. In 2D or 3D, I agree. Mike Green said, this game is a masterpiece. One word to describe this game, Kafka. Best villain in all of Final Fantasy and debatably all of video games. Yeah, in our Expansion Pass archives, we have one where we did a Mount Rushmore of gaming villains. Kafka came up a lot. He's been in one game. Against the Bowsers and the Ganons and the Eggmans. Like, Kefka's all time. All time. Akai Same. I hope I said that right. Said, I never did Final Fantasy VI until it released on the Pixel Remaster 2 years ago, if I remember correctly. And man, what a blast this game is. The game is super fun to play. The story was good. But I didn't like how they changed the names of Saban's skills. Otherwise, I 100% this game. And if I had to score it based on how many main games there is on the franchise, I'd give it a solid 12 out of 16. And it is sure my top 10 favorite Final Fantasies, but I definitely love some better than this one. Wow. I mean, I don't know if it's not my number one. I'll rank them all someday, but I don't know if I could bring myself to drop it out of the top three, even though I love some better. It's just too good. It's just too damn good. Normal Normie said, I can't sing the praises of my favorite video game of all time enough without a massive wall of text, so I'll just let the work speak for itself and relate why it is so special to me. I normally don't read really long comments, but I can see the passion in Normie's comment here, so we're going to go, if you're on 2x speed, maybe pull it back to 1x speed for this. I never owned an SNES, I had a Genesis, but my brother was able to buy one later in its life cycle, and the only game I cared about was SimCity. That is, until his friend brought over Final Fantasy IV and made us watch. Eventually, I was able to start my own game, but I couldn't beat it then, still I was obsessed with it. So when I heard Final Fantasy VI was being released, I saved up $80 and bought my first new game at retail price, and it was for a system I didn't even own. I would go on to spend hundreds of hours on countless playthroughs, being so enthralled by the game, it never occurred to me to play anything else all summer break. I still have my original copy and inherited my brother's SNES after all these years. Since it released in 94, I've tried several times to start a playthrough with my daughter, and we get a little further each time before she loses interest, but I don't want to force her to love it as I do. I know when she's ready to love this game, the love for this game will capture her the same as it has me. Yeah, it's a tough game for, I don't know how old your daughter is, but it's tough for like a little kid, but I agree. Final Fantasy IV was the one that got me into RPGs too. I don't love them, but that was where I started, so I like it. That's good shit. And Morgan McDonald said, this was a day one purchase for me when I was a kid. One of the first games I bought with my own money. Played the shit out of it, grinding every single character to level 99. Still one of my favorite games today and possibly one of the darkest video games of all time. It's hard to describe the level of death, loss, and horror that permeates, sorry Adam, every chapter of this story as a villain. Kafka is the GOAT. No apologies needed. I know the word permeate. It's like how you make sausages. And I agree with just about everything you just said. And it's time to talk about it. I got Darth Skywalker on line one. I've got former Hall of Famer Mark McHugh on line two. I'm here on line three, which is bullshit because it's my fucking podcast, but I digress. Let's talk Final Fantasy VI. I am going to cue up some of that beloved music. And when it stops, we're going to go back to October 11th, 1994, which was when Final Fantasy III released on the Super Nintendo here in North America. I hope you all enjoy this very long podcast. Let's go. All right, as I'm sure I mentioned off the top of the episode and everything, it's kind of a two birds with one stone episode because it is one of our revisited episodes, but it's also one of our stupid, sexy sponsored episodes. And joining me this week for his second appearance on one of these episodes is longtime supporter of the show and my friend Mr. Darth Skywalker. It's been a little while, buddy. How you been?
Yeah, much lighter, I have to say, man. I think in this episode we don't have any chance of finishing RTG, right? As the last time.
No.
So yes. Yeah, I'm much lighter this time.
Yeah, if anyone doesn't know, the last time Darth was on was because he sponsored an episode about Metal Gear Solid 3. And if you haven't listened to it yet, just before you go back and listen to it, please know that I'm quite hard on that game. And I was quite worried about the blowback, which actually turned out to be not quite as bad as I anticipated. This week, it's just all positives. This is like, we're talking Final Fantasy VI, which we'll put it out there one time so everybody isn't confused. This is Final Fantasy 3 on the Super Nintendo. It's just every time we talk about 2 or 4, 3, 6, we got to bring that up. And
let's agree that we can learn new things, right? It's 6.
Yeah.
Come on. It's Final Fantasy 6.
It is Final Fantasy 6. But like, I get how like when we originally covered it back on like episode 9 or something.
You spent 20 minutes debating that. Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, people were, and I still have people that message and they're like, so what, like, so is this 3 or 6? And it is a confusing thing. But you're right. Now that like all the Final Fantasy games are pretty readily available around the world, I think we can all collectively get on the same page and just say, this is officially 6. Let's just end this. This is Final Fantasy 6. So Darth, I want to know from you, my friend, Why Final Fantasy VI? I mean, I think I know why, because it's so good. But why Final Fantasy VI? Why do you like this game so much?
When we started talking about me sponsoring some episodes, from the beginning was always going to be 2. We always talked about that. And it seems naive to say right now, but my idea is that was going to be 1 for the community and 1 for me. The 1 for the community was going to be Metal Gear Solid 3 because I said, I'm going to be responsible for Adam making peace with that franchise. Yeah, we all know how that went.
Yeah, so. Yeah, it didn't quite work out, but I appreciate the effort, though.
Yeah, and when I was thinking about the 1 for me, I always thought about a Star Wars game because it's the IP that I love the most. I really love Star Wars. So, but my favorite movie is a Star Wars. My favorite book is a Star Wars book. But my favorite game is not a Star Wars game. And the best game for Star Wars, you already covered as well, which was the KOTOR, the Knights of the Old Republic. That's KOTOR's an amazing game.
So good. KOTOR is so good.
So I said, okay, so if it's not a Star Wars, what I'm going to sponsor for the second one? And then as soon when I was thinking of sponsoring an episode, it was also when you were starting to discuss, like, I don't know if I'm going to continue to do the revisited episodes. And I said, what? You're not going to go back to Final Fantasy VI? And I'm going to be fair. When I talked to you, you said, no, I am going to continue. I plan to go back. But then the third reason came up. And that triggers me a little bit. Because I don't know if you know that, Adam, but you put Final Fantasy VI three times in the Play 1, Remake 1, Erase 1. And guess what fucking happened every fucking time? You erased this
every
game.
Time.
Yes. I said,
now,
I was going
to
say, not in
fair,
my
though,
house, but it's your house, but not on my watch.
Yeah. It's like, I want to, like, it depends on, like, I want to just make sure I make this clear. Like, I want to know why Darth picked it. I'll tell you all about what I think of this game in a minute. But just before anybody, like, rage quits this episode, let me just say, like, I am very fond of this game. I just have more nostalgia for other ones, which we'll get into. But I have practically nothing bad to say about Final Fantasy VI. It is almost a flawless video game. Yeah. So,
and to be fair, you're always very positive in your episode about Final Fantasy VI, but no. You're going to raise this game three times. And actually, you raised four times because in the expansion pass, and free plug for you, everyone that want to listen to that, $3 reduce, amazing content. But you were raised the entire Final Fantasy franchise there. So, no. Not in my life.
So, obviously, you love Final Fantasy, and you and I were talking about this off air. Whenever you look up a list of the best Final Fantasy games, if six isn't number one, you can't have one of those lists without it being in the top three.
Yeah,
and I think if it isn't in the top three, your list is going to lose some credibility. It's all subjective, but there's even a limit to subjectivity. Like, come on now, why I assume this is your favorite. Why is this your favorite? Like, is this your first Final Fantasy?
Not really, and I have a different or a strange story with Final Fantasy because I was really lucky with Final Fantasy because I lived in Brazil when I was a kid, and today, of course, Brazil is a huge market, and I live in Europe now, also a huge market. Every game is released at the same time, everywhere. There is nothing like that. But in the 80s, in the 90s, was not like that. Things took time to get to other markets. Even in Europe here, where I live today, we have a lot of games that were released much later than it was in the US or Canada, I think, as well. Yeah. So we were like 5 years before you guys when it came to games. But I was really lucky because I had a friend of my mother that lived in Japan at the time. And she used to send us a lot of stuff. And she sent me all the Final Fantasy. So I played actually 1, 2, 3, but all of them in Japanese.
Yeah. Can you read Japanese?
No.
How do you play? How do you do that? People do that. How do you fucking play a game that's all text when you can't read the text?
I had a notebook where I used to draw all the letters. It doesn't matter if it's a kanji or a katakana, hiragana. They have three different alphabets in Japan. I know a little bit of Japanese now, but I used to draw everything that I saw in the game and say, okay, when I press this one, the guy's attack. So I know that this one is the attack one. When I press this, so I had a notebook where I said, okay, if I want to cure someone, I have to go to this one. I want to attack this one, yeah.
That is dedication, friend. That is, I don't think I'm that dedicated. That is dedication. Okay, yeah. So if it wasn't your first, is it your favorite?
Yes, it is my favorite. I think the only one that stacks up to six is nine.
I agree.
And here, just giving a little bit why I put six ahead of nine is because I think the cast of characters on both are perfect. The story on both are perfect. But we have one thing that puts six ahead of nine, which is the antagonist. Because Kafka kicks Kuja's ass so much. So that's why I think
Kafka is like, I'm not going to sit here and definitively say that Kefka is the greatest villain in the history of video games, but he is he's in that conversation. Like, he is the Joker of RPG villains. Like, he's, because he's got no purpose. Like, he's just a chaos.
Yeah.
He's just an asshole. He just wants to watch. Some people just want to watch the world burn, and that is Kafka, and it makes it brilliant. He's such a brilliant villain, and I agree with you. That alone does kind of, like, then you add in all the great protagonists and everything else. Sure, but you're right. The great villain kind of puts it over the top. I agree.
Yeah, and 6 and 9 are my two favorite ones. Is the ones that I think are S tier. I don't think any other Final Fantasy can stack. If you can count Final Fantasy Tactics, I think it's in this conversation. It would be then my third one, and would be S tier as well. But then after that, we have Final Fantasy IV, I think, as well. Or Final Fantasy VII Remake, if they don't fuck up with the two next games. Because this one is really, really good.
I literally agree with that whole thing. Like, that would be, like, my top five Final Fantasies in some order would probably be 4, 6, 9 Tactics, and 7 Remake. If you can take M from anywhere. Like, to me, those are the, like, those are my favorites, for sure. And it's so tough, man, because 6... Like, 4 was my first, so 4 will always be my favorite. But I just, like, I'm replaying 6 right now to get ready for this show, and it literally does, like, everything 4 does better. Like, everything.
Yes.
It's like Super Mario Brothers 3 to Final Fantasy 4 or Super Mario Brothers.
Yeah, I agree. And, like, that's why I think, and that's why I think 6 is my favorite one, because I agree with you. I don't know if it's the first one. We're going to have a lot of people coming, actually, there was another game that made the story better.
Sure.
I don't know. But for me, the first game that had a good story that I played was actually Final Fantasy IV. But it's a very lighthearted story, if you think about it. There's not big themes that talk about that they talk about it. When 6 came, if you think about it, the main theme of 6 is loss, right? Because every character that we have there that we're playing with, they lost something.
Yeah.
And they touch some very strange topics for, and I know this is not a Nintendo game, but it was only on a Nintendo console at the time.
Yeah.
So I don't know how Nintendo's let a game talked about suicide.
Yeah.
Because
agreed.
That scene with Celeste, I think, and I love
for the record,
that
sorry. For the record, everybody. We're spoiling. I just want to say it. Spoil away. Yeah. Spoil away.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Because that scene with Celeste, and it starts great because it's trying to show you that she has a routine by repetition. You have to always get a fish for trying to save Sid, right?
Yeah.
And I love that part. And that's actually, and then when she loses Sid, and she said, I lost everything, she tries to kill herself. And I said, holy fuck, what's happening here?
Yeah.
This is just not a game.
I had forgotten all about that until I was replaying it. And I was like, Jesus. And what's crazy is that, like, spoilers, everybody. I think one of the coolest things about this game is the fact that the villain wins.
Yes.
Like, I was playing it and I was like, this is Endgame from like the MCU. I'm like, the villain won.
Exactly. And that's my favorite thing. That's a perfect analogy because this is exactly the Thanos is napping, and that's my favorite MCU movie as well because of that. When Kafka won, I remember as a kid I was in front of the TV saying, what the fuck happened?
Yeah, like, you think you lost the game. You're like, did I is it over? And then there's a whole second half of the game, but the bad guy won.
Yes.
So then Celeste wakes up, and then it's like all she has is Sid, and then Sid dies, and then it's like, I don't blame her. Like, the world is over. She doesn't know that any of her friends are still alive. Like, brilliant. Brilliant.
And that's just an example, because if you think about it, like, Gao's story, it's about abandonment. He has a horrible father because we find his father and he said, no, I don't want that kid, that wild kid. Strago also, in the World of Ruin after Kafka wins, he also is grieving because he thinks he lost Realm. So, and not to mention Cyan as well, that loses his family. So I think this was the first game that I was playing and I said, this is more than a game. Oh, yeah. Of course, I don't know, 13, 14 when I first played this. It was not like with my Monaco and my pocket watch saying, oh, this is a work of art. This is better than Picasso. Of course not. But it's probably the first time that I said, this is more than a game. I think this is more than a hobby. I really love this. I love this game.
So, yeah, it's just you could easily make Final Fantasy VI just into a movie or a TV show, and it would work.
You can remake it like Final Fantasy VII, but it's always fucking VII that gets all the love.
Always, yeah, always. VII prints the money. I would love to see VI in this style, in the Final Fantasy VII remake style.
Oh, yeah.
Because you're right, and you said it, like, it's a dark game, and I wanted to ask you, like, I think they do a great job. Like, I love most of the protagonists, not all of them. But I love most of the protagonists, not just because they all have their own abilities and then you get the customizable abilities with the espers and you can kind of build them however you want. But most of them have decent stories. Not all, but most of them have decent stories as well.
I'd go a little bit further than that. I think all of them, but three, have good stories.
Yeah.
Of course, Gogo has no story at all. It's just the copy, the copy ability. Yeah. Umaru has no story at all.
He is the worst.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say that I hate that. I fucking hate that thing. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and Mog has no story, but Mog is a Moggle. And
Mog doesn't need a story.
Exactly. It's just like it's a staple of the franchise that you're playing with them for the first time. I really like that. So
And two of the three you just listed are optional. So I'm okay with less of a story because why spend all this time on a story for a character you may not find anyway?
You can all of them are optional, right? Because after the Kafka wins, you can actually just finish the game with Setzer and Edgar. That's it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. That's crazy. That's what you need. Like, that's fuck. I can't even fathom because I find that final castle tough. Unless I grind like a motherfucker. Yes, I can't imagine going in there with just a small party.
But I think that's actually a good thing about the game as well, because it is very open in the second part. I know that you mentioned that it's something that you don't like. You like when your games are a little more linear. I like that too. But in this case, the game, even if you don't need you, the game kind of pushes you to try to find everyone because you are seeing the stories. You see, for example, when you find Strago and you see he like, oh, I lost Realm. And then I have to find Realm to help this old guy.
Yeah.
So it pushes you to go, and that's one thing that I love about this game as well, that even if you have different stories, and there's a lot of secret stuff as well in this game. It was the first time that we saw that, because, for example, the dream sequences that Shadow has, that doesn't confirm, but it's pretty well known that, he is Helm's father. You don't know that if you don't have the dream sequences with him. Did you know that you can actually save Cid as well? Cid doesn't need to die.
I actually read that today. I didn't read how. I just read that it was an option to see. I had never, he's always died on my watch. So maybe I'm just not good at taking care of people. I did not know that was an option.
Yeah, you have to actually, because what happens there is that he has a HP count that is counting. Even when you are in the menu, it's always counting down. And you have always to get the fastest fish because it's the one that gives more HP. And quickly give it to him. And then you can, if you put him to, I think it's 256 HP, he doesn't die.
I did not know that. Wow. What a game. Like, it's just, there's so much to it. I wanted to ask you, like, fuck, this is going to go long. This is going to be a long episode.
About this game.
Who are your five favorites in the team? Do you have, I want to, not just personality wise, but your skills, everything. Have you got, because I could easily rattle off a list. I'm just curious.
Yeah, me too. So my two favorites, and even the story as well, I love them, is the twins, Edgar and Sabin.
Me too.
Love those guys. Shadow, of course, he's the coolest guy.
He might just be the coolest Final Fantasy character across any Final Fantasy game.
And he has a plus. He has a dog.
Shadow's the shit.
Yeah, I like Celeste as well. I really like Celeste. Actually, we didn't do the entire ranking, but I really like Final Fantasy XIV as well. I spent more than 2,000 hours in that game.
I love it.
My character is called Celeste Palazzo, which is Kafka's last name.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So Celeste, and then I like Locke as well. Especially because of his relationship with Celeste. It's a very interesting relationship between those two. And Mog. I love Moggles. So,
yeah. Yeah, I think ours are, I'll keep my cards closer to the chest, but they're pretty close. Okay. I think those are pretty definitive, yeah. Especially the twins, like the Saban and Edgar, like those two guys are just, not only are they like cool characters and I like the story of them and everything, yeah. But they're easily two of the most useful characters in the game too.
Dude, like, when they showed that he had a coin with the same side on both, my God, it was, holy fuck, that is awesome.
Yeah. And I love the relationship between them. And then, like I said, in the early going, like, dude, Edgar and the crossbow in the first couple hours
holy
of this
fuck.
Game are...
Out of crossbow, my God.
OP. Like, they're OP, that crossbow. And then Saban is just a beast through the entire game.
And he can suplex a train, right?
And he can suplex a train.
that's the best thing in the game.
I love that because there's so many things in this game that move doesn't work on. But the train, it's like, yeah, that's fair. You can suplex a train.
Exactly.
I love it. Saban's fucking. I love those guys. Do you have a who's your? Is there someone you like the least? I already said I hate that snowman thing. Whatever. I fucking hate
Umaro.
That
yeah. It's not that I hate the characters, but yeah, Umaro and Gogo, just because they don't have a lot of background. And what you mentioned there, that's one of the things that I love the most about this game as well, is that you don't have a main character if you think about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Of course. I don't know if you still call Tina or you already know that her name is Tara.
Yeah.
Yeah. But she is, of course, in the cover of the game. She's the one that you start playing with.
Yeah.
But you can do the entire game without her as well. So I don't think we have a main character here. You choose the one that you want to be a main character.
Yeah.
You can even choose the sprite that you want to see in the map. That's
awesome. I think that's a great point. Like in so many RPGs, even when you can pick a party, like Chrono Trigger, you have to have Chrono. Mario RPG, yep. You got to have Mario, right? I like that in this game, like you said, every time you get a chance to make a party, unless it's a specific like story thing or something, you can pick whoever you want. I can't remember who it was, and I apologize because someone listening to this is the one that brought it up. We were debating who is the main protagonist of this game, and I was like, I think if you have to pick someone, it's Tara because of her relationship with the Espers.
Mm-hmm.
Like she's the common link. But I'm like, I would hear an argument for Celeste. I would hear an argument for Locke. Yes. Like it's. I would hear an argument for fucking Kafka. Quite frankly,
I was gonna say let's just agree that Kafka is the main character.
And he is. I love that guy. Is he when he Kafka poisoning that water? Is like one of my favorite.
Yes.
Like I think that is one of the most iconic Final Fantasy moments of all time.
Yes, because and the what he says, right? There is nothing like the sound of hundreds of voices screaming.
Yeah,
holy crap!
That's when you see just like most villains in most games are like, I want to rule the world, or I want all the power, and like Kafka just doesn't care. Like he just doesn't care. He just wants to destroy everything, yes. And he laughs about it, and he's just.
Yeah,
horrible.
And actually another plug for you because you also were discussing kind of this topic on the Rambling Idiot one time, the nihilism. I don't know how we're calling it here, right?
Nihilism.
Nihilism. Yes. That's how we say it here. Great.
Yeah.
So he has the dark side of nihilism because he doesn't care about anything. And then he says, why do something then? And actually I put the one of the quotes from him just so I don't butcher. But he says, I think it's just before the last battle that he says, when time will destroy all those as well, why do people insist on creating things that will inevitably be destroyed?
Yeah.
Why do people cling to life knowing that they must someday die, knowing that none of these will meant anything once they do? That's freaking awesome. You have philosophy in a game now as well. So,
yeah, it's insane. He like I've said it countless times. I think... The Joker is the definitive villain in all forms of media. Like, I think he is the greatest villain ever. Like, I think I think Darth Vader is up there. I think, you know, like, there's some great villains, but I look at the Joker and I'm like, he's the epitome of, like, when you use the comparison, like, if you're like, I'm a Montreal Canadiens fan and our arch rivals are the Boston Bruins. And like, whenever I talk to a Bruins fan, like, the agreement is that, like, we can't, Batman without the Joker is nothing. Like the Joker is that character everybody goes to. And I look at Kafka and I'm like, he is the video game Joker outside, I guess, of the Joker in Batman video games. But like he's so good. Like, cause he's just like it's almost infuriating because you're like, he's destroying all of us and we're fighting so hard to stop him and he doesn't even have a point.
And he's winning, right?
Yeah.
He's winning. That's the problem.
When he wins, I think that's like, because you mentioned the Dark World and I didn't like it so much playing it the first time because I don't like the open world part. I enjoyed it a lot more this time. And I think it was because the story just hits so well and you want to see what's happened to everybody. Like you want to find all your friends. You want to see what happened to all of you since the world burned.
Yeah, and not only that, you talk to NPCs, right? And they go like, yeah, we have to behave because otherwise Kafka can just come here and destroy all of us. And you say, oh my God.
it's fucked, man. It's such a brilliant video game. I love it. Fuck me. We're at almost 25 minutes already. Okay. I'm going to shut up, Darth. I have more to say. You've got a couple minutes. Is there any other points of this game that you're like, the world's listening, that you have to get off your chest that you've been waiting to bring up?
I think one thing that we didn't talk about it yet, and we need to talk about when we discuss this game, is the soundtrack. Because I know you always talk about Mega Man is the best soundtrack. Again, you are not wrong, but you are not right as well.
Yeah.
Because this game has the best song. I know that you don't like this as well, but the opera sequence. It was another time in this game that I thought, what is happening here? We have an opera in the SNES game?
Yeah.
What's happening?
I agree with the music. I think the music's spectacular. I particularly love the boss fight music in this game. Like, I love it. That will be in this episode somewhere, I promise.
And Kafka's theme. Kafka Dancing Mad is...
Yeah.
It's not my favorite song in this game. It's not my favorite music in the game. But I think it's the best, technically, is the best music from Nobuo Uematsu. And I'm a fan of this guy. I actually already saw him playing live.
He
was playing the piano. Yeah. It was a Final Fantasy concert and he played some songs in the piano. The guy, for me, he's like John Williams when comparing to, Star Wars. Because even if it's a bad Star Wars game, even if it's a bad Final Fantasy game, like Final Fantasy VIII, the song is great.
Yeah,
the song is always great.
Yeah, the music in this game is fire. I will say that opera sequence, I'll get more into it in a minute, but like I think the music part of that is brilliant. I played the Pixel Remaster this time and they did an even better job with it. I will say that like I've never quite understood the like everyone hypes up that opera sequence and I just don't I love so many things about this game, but I'm like, that's just, I don't think it's bad, but I'm like, that's, I don't think that's the coolest part of this game. That's the part everybody talks about.
It's not the coolest part, but I love it. And every time they do this live in an orchestra setup, and it sometimes is a surprise because I was in a museum here in my city. They had a gaming exposition there. And then I was, they had a concert in the beginning and they said, okay, now we're going to play a Final Fantasy song. It's always Sephiroth song. It's always that one winged angel.
Yeah,
exactly. It's always that one. And they said, yeah, we're going to, they had a person singing there. Games normally don't mix up with opera, but this one did. And I choked up. I said, oh my God, they're going to do the opera song from Final Fantasy VI. And they did.
I thought you were going to be like, and then it was goddamn Sephiroth. No. But okay, no. Then they did do it.
It was Final Fantasy VI. So like, oh my God, finally. Oh, fuck.
That's, I could have sworn, I thought you were setting it up to be like, and then they played Sephiroth again.
No.
I love it. I mean, I'm going to gush for another hour in a second here. It's just a spectacular video game from top to bottom. I can't think of a fault. Like, is there anything you don't like?
No. I think the only soundtrack that actually stacks up to this one is actually Mary's Missing in the SNES.
Oh, fuck, I'll fucking end this show right now.
I know it's Mark in the episode, so shout out to you, Mark.
Him and that fucking... Oh, fuck. What's got a great soundtrack, though? It doesn't fucking matter, Mark. You fucking idiot. All right. This has been... Fuck yeah, I love this game. Darth, I always like to let my guests come up with a scoring scale, and you said you've got one prepared, yeah?
Yes.
What do you got?
I know it's not your favorite part of this game, but like I said to you before, I do have an ulterior motive to do this. I think you should scale these on the number of playable characters, which is the largest one in any Final Fantasy game. Of course, if you don't count 14.
Sure. Yeah. No. But yeah. I'm good with. I just wanted to say that. Like, I usually don't like giant playable parties. I think this one comes right up to the line because I think it does a great job. There's not really any characters I hate outside of fucking shitty abominable snowman whose name I won't even say. Yeah, I think this one comes right up to that line. And I think 14 is perfect.
Yeah, and this game also does something that you don't have in a lot of games before that, which is the multi-part party dungeons, right? So even if you have 14 characters, you sometimes use all of them.
Yeah.
Because you have multiple parties to go to the dungeons.
The whole end, dude, that end fighting with Kefka where you basically rank all 12 and then call them in and like setting a batting lineup is so sick.
I love it. Awesome.
Yes. All right. Out of 14. I like that. What do you got? What do you want to give it?
Okay. And now I want to explain a little bit just why I'm going to do that. I don't usually like to do this. And you did this just once. And it was much more selfless than me. You did this because it was a game that saved the industry. But we know it's 14 characters, but we have one character that has a dog. So I'm going to give 14 characters and a dog out of 14.
The interceptor bonus. I love it.
Exactly.
I love it because
this game for me, it's perfect. This is my favorite game of all time. And I cannot give... You were selfless saying, I'm going to give 11 out of 10 because save the industry. I'm not. I'm going to say, I'm going to give 15 out of 14 because this is the most important game for me.
I like it. I honestly, so like you guys are about to hear my conversation with Mark about this game. We're not actually recording it for 2 days. So I have 2 days to try to figure out if there's any way I can not give this game a perfect score, especially now that I've just replayed it. I'm going to chew the fat on that for the next 2 days and then I'll come back and slap a score on it. Darth, I plan on talking to you for like 15 minutes and here we are half an hour later. That is just the magic of Final Fantasy VI. Buddy, thank you so much for doing this. Thank you for your generosity, of course, for supporting the show. And thank you for your patience, as always, because I know this took a long fucking time. Thank you, man. It was great to chat with you again.
Yeah, thanks, man. Thanks for having me.
This is going to be fun because we're covering a very special game, as you've already heard once. You've heard the intro and everything. Full disclosure, as you already know, we're spoiling everything, so spoilers are on the table here. But joining me this week to talk Final Fantasy VI is a man that needs no introduction. You may remember him from such podcasts as Purple Monkey Dishwasher. But this week he's back on the original show that started this whole thing. Mark McHugh is here, former Hall of Famer Mark McHugh, for Remember the Game. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. I'm again happy to be on. Don't get me wrong, love doing Purple Monkey Dishwasher. I'm glad to be on the show that more people listen to, though.
yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's been a while. Hey, like I can't remember the last time you were on RTG.
I think it was probably New Year's. I think this is probably my first.
Oh yeah,
Remember the Game of the year.
Holy shit! Really? You might be right. Portal might have been the last. Holy fuck! Well, welcome back. Yeah, if everybody doesn't know, I'll sneak in my last plug. You can hear Mark and I talk The Simpsons every Monday for at patreon.com/rememberthegame. We're about to go into season 2 of The Simpsons. I can't wait. But this week, we're talking about a video game that probably as good as The Simpsons is to what The Simpsons is to animated shows. I would argue Final Fantasy VI is to JRPGs.
Yeah, you know what? It's like definitely now, this is a stupid question. Is Final Fantasy VI pre or post Chrono Trigger? Do you know?
I don't know that. Similar time for sure.
There's
I don't know.
Like within a few years of each other for sure.
Yeah.
But it's I don't remember which one came first.
I'll look right now.
This whichever one came first changed everything.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's funny too because like I have never hidden the fact that like Final Fantasy IV, which was 2 on the Super Nintendo, is my favorite. Just because it was the one I started with. But every time I play this one, like Final Fantasy VI, I'm like, this is the better game. Like it literally like Final Fantasy IV walked, so this game could run like a world record 100-meter dash. Like this game knocked it out of the it's so good. It's practically perfect, truth be told. Oh, FYI. Oh my gosh. So Final Fantasy VI.
But there will be things I'm bitching about for sure.
Sure, sure. Yeah, oh yeah, no question. Final Fantasy VI hit North America on October 11th, 94. Chrono Trigger hit North America on August 11th, 95. So within 10 months of each other, they released Final Fantasy VI and Chrono Trigger.
Which, that's a crazy year.
That's insane. But most studios don't have two games that good in their lifetime.
And I've always thought that Chrono Trigger should have been just called, like, Final Fantasy, I mean, in this case, 7.
Yeah.
Like, because it is just a Final Fantasy game.
Yeah, I mean, they changed the formula a little bit with, like, the enemies on the screen and stuff. But it is, yeah, it is. I'm a little bit sorry. I promise everybody we're talking Final Fantasy VI. But, like, I just, like, where is Chrono Trigger? Like, how have they not done anything with that game?
I don't know. I'm like, floored. I can't even get it on anything.
No. I have it on I bought it on Steam.
Like, and it's I guess, Steam, like, you can buy, like, I don't know if you can on the PlayStation 5, but I know on the PS3, I was able to buy, like, the original PS1 port. But, like, man, the PS1 port of Chrono Trigger is bad. Like, yeah, that's not the load version. It's the worst version of the game by, like, a lot.
Yeah. It's crazy because, like, let's put our cards on the table here. Square Enix, Square Soft, whatever you want to call them from back then and now, whatever. Square, the Square company, they are not shy about asking you to buy Final Fantasy games over and 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 over. But Chrono Trigger, they're like, nobody wants this.
But it's like everybody wants this.
Yeah, everybody wants this.
Like, it's universally accepted that Chrono Trigger is, like, one of the best games of all time. And they're just like, yeah, but, like, I don't know. It's, like, dusty. There's cobwebs on it. You guys don't want to play that. What about Final Fantasy 16? You guys really want to play Final Fantasy 16, right?
Yeah, it's very odd.
It's like, I get, like, yes, obviously new games are great, but, like, let us play the old ones as well. And also, I swear to God that this episode is not just going to be me bitching about Final Fantasy 16, but that's also going to be in here for sure.
Okay, don't spoil that, though, because I'm not done that one yet.
Yo, you're not done Final Fantasy 16?
I'm getting close, but I'm not. So don't spoil that one.
Okay, but you know how it ends.
No, I don't.
Okay, well, like...
So I swear on my life, Mark, I will fucking drive to Calgary and fight you. Like, I put so many hours into that fucking game. If you ruin the ending for me, I will fight you.
Okay. I won't say anything about the end of this JRPG.
All right. We're talking 16, right? Not 6.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Because I was like, 6 I have. 6 we're spoiling like crazy.
Yes, 6 will spoil all day.
On the note of Final Fantasy, as we kind of segue over to Final Fantasy, I'm putting you kind of on the spot here. Do you have a top 3 in no particular order? Like, do you have a top 3 Final Fantasy games?
There's a lot that I haven't played. So, like, keep in mind this isn't a comprehensive list. But Final Fantasy, like, Final Fantasy VI is the GOAT. I really like Final Fantasy I. Like, the original Final Fantasy. Okay. And you know what? I'm going to say it. I like Final Fantasy VII Remake more than Final Fantasy VII.
Oh, buddy. To me, it's not even close. Like, and I liked VII back in the day, but Remake is so much better.
Like, Remake, I liked. It was fine. I don't know if it was, like, the mind-blowing thing that everybody said that it was. But VII Remake was, like... Like, I played that game all the way through in, like, 3 days because I couldn't put it down.
Same here. Like, I cannot wait. It's my most anticipated game of any system is Final Fantasy VII Remake Part 2 or Rebirth or whatever the fuck it's called.
And,
like, I can't wait.
I picked it up and I was like, oh, man, like, they're you know, they're remaking this game, but they're going to, like, flesh it out so much. They're going to do what Peter Jackson did to The Hobbit and just, like, stretch it out so much that it looks nothing like it. And then I played it and I was like, oh man, they did a really good job of making, like, just one full game out of this one section of Final Fantasy VII. And totally. I cannot wait to see what they do next.
Yeah. The Hobbit reference went right over my head.
Okay. So The Hobbit, like, yeah, Peter Jackson did a Hobbit trilogy when it is the shortest book of the series.
Okay.
So like, you know how like the three Lord of the Rings each got a movie, and of course they were all like 1,000 hours long.
Yeah, I never saw
those. But like those were long books. The Hobbit was the shortest book in the series, and he stretched that into three movies. And as a result, like you had three movies that were like, fine. Nice. Like, that last movie wasn't that last movie was the end of a movie that they stretched out for like 2 hours. And so like when they came up with like extended editions of The Hobbit, I'm like, no, other way. I want a cut of The Hobbit trilogy that's like maybe 4 hours long, one sitting. I don't want a 9-hour Hobbit movie.
I see. I get it. Okay. Well, that's fair. Cause like, I was going to say like to me, it's always been some order of 4, 6, and 9 are the three best, my three favorite Final Fantasies. And arguably to me, the three best, like I think 9 is spectacular, but
see, I never played 9. So
oh, buddy, you'll love it. I promise. It's a great game.
I've played 10. I liked 10.
Yeah. 10's okay.
I played half of 15 and it was like,
Yeah, I hate that game.
Oh, really? Okay. Glad I was the only 15. One that couldn't get into it.
No, I hate 15. But 6, like when you look up a list of like the greatest Final Fantasy games and like ranking them and stuff, like it's obviously very subjective, but I feel like the one lock is Final Fantasy 6 will be in the top 3, if not number 1. Like it always is. And like, the first time I played it, I didn't play it until I was an adult. As a kid, I never owned it. I played Final Fantasy 2 on the Super Nintendo, Final Fantasy 4 all the time. I never played 6. And then when I finally did, I was like, this is good. This is good. I don't like games where I have to manage a big party of people because I always feel like I'm leaving too many people behind and I don't know who to use and I feel like I'm fucking it up. And I feel like 6 comes right to the cusp of like too many. It just, like one more playable character might have been too many.
That said, but I like the number of playable characters. Like I feel like Final Fantasy as a series, like the strength of this game is that there wasn't a main character. Yes. There kind of was in Terra, but like for the most part, there's not really just one character that's focused on. You have all of these characters that all have their own story arcs. And that's what like makes this game's story so strong. Whereas like most Final Fantasies over the last 20 years have been just like, okay, so we've got a guy. He's kind of good looking and he's got like spiky hair and he's grumpy. And he like talks like this weird, like it's been the same character in every Final Fantasy game. And it's like, oh my God, we fucking get it. And 16, again, not going to bitch about 16 the whole time, but it's the same thing. It's the same fucking dude with the spiky hair and the like 1,000-yard stare, like expression, and just like the whole like, I'm too cool for anything thing. And it's like, Jesus Christ, somebody throw a fucking pie, right?
No, I don't disagree, especially like, I think that's a great point. I was debating that with somebody in the community, like who is the protagonist of Final Fantasy VI? And it's like, I think if you're forced to pick somebody, I think it's Terra. Just because Terra, I think her connection to the Espers and the like, it's she's the link.
She sparks the plot. She gets like the big final moment of the game. Like
it is
kind of her story, but it's not only her story, which sets this apart from future Final Fantasy titles.
Agreed. I think that's one of the great things they do is that not only is like because you can make an argument to me that you can make an argument that Celeste is the main character. I'd hear an argument for Locke. I'd hear an argument for Kefka, even though he's not a hero because he's the greatest villain ever. And but I Kefka's think he's
He's got Kefka's on screen more than some of the playable characters.
Yeah. And I think they do a great job of flushing out most of the characters. There's the two additional characters that I don't even like to acknowledge. The shitty snowman. Yeah, the City Yeti guy and then the Go-Go or whatever the fuck he's called. I can't stand either of them. But by and large, they do a great job of flushing out these characters and making you care about them. And I think it's just so I love that, and I mentioned this when I was talking to Darth. Like, I love that in almost every RPG, when you can build a party, you need to keep the like you need to keep Mario in Mario RPG, you need to keep Chrono in Chrono Trigger. And in this one, they're like, do whatever the fuck you want. They're like, unless it's like a specific mission where you need to have a particular character for that mission. They're like, do whatever you want, especially when you get into the end game and you go to the dark world. Like, you can completely miss members of your team and not re-recruit them. You can re-recruit them and never use them. Yeah, like, I think it's... And again, I'm normally overwhelmed. Like, I've tried playing, like, Suikoden 2, and I just couldn't get into it, even though I thought it seemed great. I'm like, I don't want to balance a team of this many characters. I struggle with it in Pokemon. I feel like I'm leaving too many characters behind. Like, that is a big problem for me. And I think this one does a great job of just walking that line of like just enough characters, and you really only need to build up. Like, I know you could beat the game with just a few people, but like that final tower where you have to divide into three teams, and then when you go to fight Kefka, you need to take 12 party members and like count them down, which I love. I fucking love that.
I love that. Like, and again, like Final Fantasy has never done that again.
No.
At the very least, not that I've seen. Again, like a lot of games that I didn't play. But like that whole part where like you have these big epic battles where you have to like split your team into three. And like, okay, you have to put like this team over here, this team over here. You got to make sure that each team has like a healer, somebody who can like, so like with strong magic attacks. Is a really, really like, it's a really cool system. And it breaks my heart a little bit that we haven't seen it since. That said, end of the month, we're getting Sea of Stars. Do you know anything about that game?
Yeah. That's the prequel to The Messenger.
It's the prequel to The Messenger, but it also looks a lot like this. And yeah, I'm hoping that they've borrowed the right elements from it.
Yeah, it looks dope. And it's coming to both Game Pass and PS Plus. So like everybody can play it. Like, it's going to be awesome.
Well, and I bought it like at the beginning of its development, I supported it on the
Kickstarter.
Their Kickstarter. I get it on my Switch.
Yeah, it looks dope. Because I agree with you. Like, there haven't been a lot of games that have done it like this since. And have you ever played Final Fantasy V?
No.
Okay. So I played V a couple years ago for the show, and it's the story in Final Fantasy V is awful. Like, it's almost non-existent. But the job system in it is fucking sick. You have a party of four people, and as you go through the game, you basically unlock different parties or different jobs, and you can give them jobs however they want. And then as they level up in that job, they learn abilities, and you can mix and match. So you can make like somebody with a bunch of white magic that also uses really strong, powerful weapons. And you can make like a summoner that also has like dragoon ability. Like, you can mix and match. And I feel like what Six does so perfectly is it takes the storytelling style of Final Fantasy IV, combines it with the customization options from Final Fantasy V, and it poops out this game that is just like, the replay in Final Fantasy VI is insane, because you can like, not only do most characters, and we'll go through the characters in a second, not only do most of the characters have their own specific abilities like Saban's attacks or Edgar's tools or whatever, but then once you unlock the ability to start mixing and matching espers on most of them and letting them learn whatever magic they want, plus those espers buff certain stats so you can level them up and train them kind of however you want, and then add that into the fact that you can mix and match your team almost however you want, it's very, and it's not overwhelming to hear me talk about it. If you've never played it, it might sound overwhelming. Like, you've played it, Mark. It's not, it's brilliantly done. Like, it's simple enough to not scare anybody away, but complex enough to give you a lot of replay value.
Yeah, like, story is absolutely, like, extremely linear, except for in, like, one part, which is really, really interesting what they do with the story. So, like, there are definitely characters that you're locked into at any given time, but it's really interesting the way they do it. You get to know all of these characters.
Yeah,
because they are all going to be essential to the plot in one way or the other.
Yeah, and if like the more time you put into this game, the more you get out of it, especially again. So again, we're spoiling everything, right? Everything's on the table. If you haven't played it, I'd recommend not listening to this till you play it. Once you hit that end world, which I'd like to get into when we get to the story, because I still think it's insane that 2/3 of the way through the game, the villain wins. Like, I was saying when I was talking to Darth, it reminds me of Endgame.
It reminds me of Endgame. I was like, there's no way did that just happen.
Yeah. I thought I lost the game. And then it picks up and you're like, oh, okay, so now we're just picking up after we've lost. And then you spend this time. And to me, that's really where the storytelling gets magnificent, is in that dark world, because you can travel around and you're looking for all your allies and you're picking them back up one at a time. And you can pick up extra, like if you take Gao to the right place, you can find his dad and learn a little bit more about his background and why he was abandoned. I think you can. I didn't do it this time, but I think you can. And like, you can go into like Shadow's Pass to find out what the fuck's going on there. And you can go into,
I just love that, like, it starts with, like, again, we'll get more into it when, like, we get to the story, but, like, the world ends and you're like, what the fuck just happened? And then you just wake up on an island.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, let's do it then. Let's do the story. Let's do the story. Then we'll do the, so like, yeah, if you've never played it, it basically like, it revolves around this whole concept of, there was a war of the Magi, I guess is how you pronounce it, a long time ago. And there's these powerful like summon creatures called Espers that kind of live in like their own dimension behind this like locked away cave. So they're not there. So they're not fighting with the human. Like it's all, they're like, whatever, they're gone. And basically this like fucking psychopath Kafka is like just after the power of these Espers to start, you know, to just, and like, I think, sorry, I know I'm all over the place. Like, I really don't even know how to describe the story of this game. It's so wild. And I'll be, admittedly, I'm hungover too, but at the end of the day, like, to me, this, like, this whole story revolves around, like, you have all these characters. Some of them are parts of this rebellion against the Empire and against Kafka and them. Some of these characters have, some of these characters have nothing to do with it. They just see that this guy is a piece of shit, just going to destroy the world, and we need to stop him. Shadow on his own is like the coolest fucking character in the history of Final Fantasy. And then like 2/3 of the way through the game, you've got this whole team built and everything like this. And then finally Kafka wins. He does exactly what he set out to do. He is the Joker of video game villains. He has no purpose. It's not like he wants to rule the world per se. He just wants, like, it's such an overused line these days, but some people just want to watch the world burn.
But there's this amazing twist in the middle too, where like he's working with the Emperor Gestahl, and he was like the emperor of this whole kingdom. And halfway through the game, the emperor is just like, hey, look, peace, right? Like, I fucked up. I see what I did was bad now. We've got to work together. We've got to stop this. And what he, like, the way he says it, it sounds so incredibly reasonable. And you're like, yeah, let's do it. Like, obviously, like, I can understand why this emperor would, like, now choose to take this moment to, like, take the L and, like, really backpedal and, like, try to undo this. And then you find out, like, no, he and Kafka were working together and have double crossed you.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's, I love that part too. Yeah. Like toward the end of the light world, if you want to call it that, where you're like, oh man, it's just like, I don't want to say, cause I don't want to spoil anything, but in another popular Final Fantasy game, everyone that knows the game will know exactly what I'm talking about. When this evil company that's destroying the world then kind of joins forces with everybody else to be like, okay, we fucked up. We need to save the world before it's too late. It's a PS1 game, and I'll end it there because I think people know. But in this one, yeah, like when the Empire like invites you to come back, there's that part where you walk around and you have to talk to all the soldiers and let them know that like the war is over and everything. And I was like, wow, what a neat twist. Like, it's a great story. And I'm like, wow, this is really cool. And then, yeah. And then at the end of the day, it turns out like, and I didn't know if I could trust them to begin with. But then it was like, no, I can't trust you. It turns out that you were a piece of shit. You and Kafka were both pieces of shit. And then they get up there and there's those three statues that have been like keeping everything in line, the magic. And they fuck it up and move those statues and basically just unleash fucking like Kafka turns on everybody. I think he kills Gestahl, doesn't he? I think he does.
Yeah, he kicks him off that island.
Yeah, that's right. He kicks him off the floating island. I mean, like, fuck Emperor Gestahl too, but like still. And then Kafka just literally like unleashes hell on Earth, and then it's over. And then like a year later, Celeste wakes up and everyone else is gone and dead and the world's destroyed. And the people that are still alive are just living in constant fear of Kafka, that he's just going to destroy them.
All been like burned, like the villages you can still go to, like they've got like destroyed buildings and.
Yeah. And that used to be where the game lost me, because I don't like open world stuff. But then this time, I don't know what it was, this time replaying it, it just clicked like so well. And I loved going around that dark world and going back to all these places that I'd already been before and talking to people that I'd talked to in before everything hit the fan and seeing the fear that they're living in now and how fucked up the world is now. Well, you're also trying to reunite. Again, it's almost like Avengers Endgame. You're trying to like get your crew back together and be like, we lost, but we can still fix this. And it just feels so fucking epic. It's so, I don't even know another word to describe it. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just.
No, and like, that's it. And they did this on Super Nintendo hardware. And
yeah.
Really, like, the more you go back, like, the Super Nintendo was the, like, the console of the big epic story.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, it's, that's, I don't know if that's, like, I don't know if it's fair to say that that's where, like, games started getting stories like this, but like I can't think of an NES game that had like involved stories this deep.
No, I mean even like Final Fantasy 2 on the Super Nintendo, Final Fantasy 4, like it's got a pretty good story, but 6 gets fucking heavy. Like Darth brought this up, but like Celeste tries to kill herself because she's like, the world is over, this sucks. Like you've got like kids being abandoned by their parents, you've got this fucking maniac, like that scene, the famous scene where he poisons the water for the castle,
dude, and like, he like everybody just laughs about
it. Yeah, it is. And this is a dark like video this, game.
This dude, like, you go through this ghost train, and the guy sees his family like riding on this ghost train to the other world, and you're like,
yeah,
holy fuck, like this. Yeah, this is like they really put so much effort and thought and care into this game.
Yeah. Like, I don't,
like,
I,
and again, like, the most wild. Recent Final Fantasy game, it feels like, yeah, they wanted it to be big and epic, but, like, at no point have they made me give a shit about any of the characters, really.
Yeah, I still think that this is, like, the, arguably the gold, like, I haven't played 12, I've played just about all the other ones, minus the MMOs, and I feel like this is still among the best storytelling. And like it's and I think what makes the game the whole package is like the story is excellent, but then you add in the great combat system with the being able to customize your characters, and you add in all that other stuff. But just the story alone, like I'd watch this as like a TV series or like a movie or a book or whatever. And I don't know a lot about telling stories and writing stories. But I think you know more about this than me with plays and things. But like, isn't kind of like the cliche 101 the heroes, you need to write a story where the heroes kind of hit rock bottom? And then there's like, yeah, the redemption, like, arc, the
hero's
finish.
Journey.
Yeah. And I can't think of many games that do it as well as this. Cause like you're playing along for the first 2/3 of the game in the light world. And like, yeah, Kefka's fucked up, but you're like, we're going to stop him eventually. And you got like this happy,
you,
go-lucky,
like, a false ending. Like you get to a part of the game where everyone's like, well, everything's wrapped up. Everything's good. And that's when Kefka shows up. Cause like, you're like, okay, well that's like, you know, it was a pretty, like, you think like playing through, like, obviously, like, you like playing through now, you know, it's not the end. But the first time I played it, I got to that point. I'm like, okay, well, that was a pretty good game. It was like a good, decent length. It wasn't too long. It wasn't too short. And then like Kefka shows up and you're like, no, there's so much game left.
Yeah.
And like,
and I, yeah,
I it's, like, it's I brilliant. Do sometimes kind of hate them in because JRPGs do that a lot. And like, I've never been a huge fan of like when games tell you like it's just about over and then they drop like a whole other half of the game on it. JRPGs, the Persona series is the worst for it. And don't get me wrong, love those games, but like you'll get to a point in the game where it's just like, all right, gang, this is the last level. And you're like, okay, cool. And then there's like 5 more levels after that. And you're like, well, for fuck's sakes.
Yeah. No, it's, dude, I can't, because I agree with that. Like, I hate it when a game tries to hold on for too long. I'm not, this one doesn't at all. But I'm just saying, I hate it when games do. You think it's over, and then there's like, oh, God. And it's like, and the end is never as good as it would have been if they just ended it, you know, 3 chapters ago or whatever.
Well, but because, in JRPGs, the ending always gets weird. Like,
yeah,
you resolve the, like, conflict that was set up in the story, and then you have to kill God.
Yeah.
Like, no matter what, every JRPG ends the same way, where it's just like, we got the big bad guy, but it turns out the big bad guy was being possessed by this demon from, like, that's, like, thousands of years old, and now we've got to go kill this demon. And it's like, okay, well, like, I appreciate getting, like, a big final last boss, but, like, it always goes the same way.
Yeah. But at least, like, this one, I feel like this one does that the best, because it does do that, kind of, but it does it better. That false finish where you kind of think the game is over and then it turns out like, nope, Kafka. Like when you go up to the floating island, I always assumed, like first time playing it, I was like, this is the end of the game. I'm like, I'm going to go up there. We're going to fight Kafka. We're going to stop him. It's going to end the world. That's it. And then you like, you do this big fight and then lose. And then it's over and Kafka literally wins and destroys it all. And I can't, going back to the point I was making about the storytelling and the hero's redemption arc or whatever, like I can't think of another game that you spend two-thirds of this game happy-go-lucky, you're having fun, you're like, we're all a bunch of, we are the super friends, and you're like, we're going to stop Kafka. And then all of a sudden, it's just like, no, you lost. Go fuck yourself. And you feel for these characters. Like, you feel for Celeste laying there on that beach with Sid dying, and you're like, what the fuck? And then you start going around and finding everybody and how fucked up the world is and everything. And it really does a great job of getting you amped up to go fuck up Kafka. You know, well, you're
really,
like, no,
really,
we're going to
really
get that.
Like that when you find Tara, she's like running an orphanage.
Yeah. And she doesn't want to fight anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And then
and it's like, and for all of these kids, like she's like, okay, well we've lost. So I'm going to try to make the world better this way.
Yeah.
Like the characters aren't like, again, don't mean to bitch about Final Fantasy 16, but I'm sure like there's a random time jump in Final Fantasy 16 where I'm just like, why is there a time jump there? And then it like, because the next part of the story just feels like the, what naturally would happen next in the story.
Right.
It's like there was no reason to be like, ooh, and then this happens 5 years later. And it's like, well, why wouldn't that have happened 5 minutes later?
Right. I don't know. I mean, I can't say because I'm not done. So I don't entirely. I've liked that story, but I'm not done. So I refuse to comment on the story until I'm done because I got to see how it ends. But with six, your point being like, I don't feel like there's any fluff in this game outside of that shitty fucking abominable snowman character guy who fucking sucks.
I like the Yeti.
He's awful. But outside of him, I don't feel like there's any wasted time. Like everything's got a purpose. The ball is constantly moving. You can look around and explore if you want, but it's all building up to this epic finish. And I know we kind of glossed over the story after we said we were going to talk about the story. So much of the story is tied up in these characters and their individual stories. So like, we'll get into the individual characters in a minute because it's really hard to tell the over encompassing story without getting into some of them because they are the lifeblood of this game. But I want to move on from sucking Kefka's dick, but I have to just say it once again, dude, like he's a top three villain to me of all time in video games. Like he is just, I don't think he's been done as well as he like since. And everyone talks Sephiroth and how cool Sephiroth is. And Sephiroth is cool. Sephiroth isn't a fraction of as evil a villain as Kafka is. Kafka is the Joker of video games.
Well, because you can see the threat that Kafka poses at all times. Like a lot of video game villains will be like, ooh, there's a bad guy and he's going to do bad things. And it's always kind of like, well, when? Like, okay, we've got like, even in Zelda, like you wake up and like it's like, oh, you got to go fight Ganondorf. And it's like, why? It's like, well, because he's going to do something bad. And it's like, well, he's not right now. He's just chilling in the castle waiting for me to get there right now, actually.
Well,
or like,
and
ooh, got to go fight Bowser. And it's just like, well, he kidnapped the princess. So I guess we got to go after him. But like, at no point do you sense like any real danger from some of these villains. Whereas like Kefka's like, no, I'm going to poison the fucking water. I am going to, you know, I am going to like end the world. I'm going to do whatever it takes to get what I want. And it's like, that's a really, really good sign of a villain when he poses an immediate threat like that.
Yeah. And I feel like so many villains, like they're not good, but you can see like why they're like, they have an end goal. You know what I mean? It's like, I want all the power. I want to rule the world. I want to avenge this. I'm mad because of this. Kafka is that. It's, do you remember that fucking line from The Dark Knight where the Joker's like, I'm like a dog chasing a car. If I ever catch it, I don't know what I do with it. Like that's Kafka. He's like, yeah. I don't even know why I'm here. I just want to fuck with everybody. I hate all of you. I hate everything.
He just wants all the magic power.
There's literally no, like, it doesn't, like, I'm like, dude, I'm like, I could see Bowser joining up with Mario. He has. I could see Ganon and Zelda or Link working together if some other bigger power came and they needed to. Like, it's, you know, like, I mean, like, I'm like, Sephiroth, I could see Sephiroth helping you if need be. It's like, Kefka will never help anyone. He's just a piece of shit. And it makes him so great. And it makes this game, because that's the yin and the yang of the game. And like, oh my God, we're half an hour in. Okay. The villain's great. We can agree the dark side of the coin is spectacular. I want to talk more about the heroes, the light side of the coin. Let's do the break here. Let's do the ad break here. Then we'll do that. Then we still have to get into the fucking mechanic system. And it just, God, this is a big game. We'll be right back.
If you're an athlete, you know the greatest motivator of all is the fear of letting your teammates down. After all, a team is only as good as its weakest link. So you owe it to those wearing the same jersey as you to be your best every time you step on the field. That's why there's no vape in team. When you vape, you can expose your lungs to toxic chemicals that can damage your lungs. If you're a step behind, the team's a step behind. Brought to you by The Real Cost and the FDA.
Okay, let's talk heroes. Mark, straight out of the gate, putting you on the spot. Who's your favorite good guy in this game? Good protagonist, that's the word. Who's
I think
your favorite
Tara. Hero? I think Tara is like the heart of the story.
Yeah, I mean, I think she, like, Shadow's my favorite because Shadow's so fucking cool.
I mean, but, Shadow's cool, yeah, but it's like very like mercenary, like, I'll work for whoever pays me.
Yeah, but he's got a dog and he's that cool music.
Interceptor, yeah, it's like, yeah. You know what? The dog is like, I like the dog more than Shadow.
Oh, I love Shadow. I love that Shadow. Like,
I like the dog more.
I mean, okay, I'm not going to argue with you because it's a dog. But all right, well, that's okay. So Tara is kind of the straw that stirs the drink. She's like the girl that's like half Esper, half human.
She's a badass. I like the Locke and Celeste dynamic.
Me too. Yeah, I like. So you start with Tara, and she's like that, and then you get Locke after that, who's like the cool thief. I feel like Locke, like the
Locke's
first time
a useless character, but like his story.
Yeah, so let's do that while we talk about the characters. We'll quickly explain what their abilities are. So, like, because just about every character in the game has some form of additional ability with them. So Tara is one of the characters that can use magic early in the game. Most characters can't until later on in the game. Tara can, but then she's also half decent at throwing damage. And then later in the game, she's got this ability to go, like, supersonic. Yeah, and turn into fucking, like, Esper Tara, where she looks awesome and she's more powerful and all her magic, like, and she is like she's unofficially kind of the leader of the team, like, she's the, because she's the most powerful one, like, that's the way I interpret it anyways. I don't think she's the best character to use, but that is like her, that's what she does, that makes her cool. Locke is like the badass thief who's like, I think he's one of the cooler characters. I agree, outside of being able to steal you some good items, he's pretty useless.
Yeah, like, as far every as, like, time using I was him. Stuck with him, I was like, well, fuck, man.
Yeah.
Like, there's not much this character can do.
No. And what I love about this game is the customization, which we'll get to when we get to that part of this discussion. And so you can, to an extent, like, if you grind enough, you can basically make any character to just about anything you want. But as far as, like, their individual abilities, I agree. Locke, like, stealing is kind of neat every once in a while when you get, like, a really cool item. But by and large, he's kind of meh. He's a very meh character as far as what he does in combat. As far as his character, like, being one of the returners and, like, trying to save everybody. And, like, he, in some ways, he feels like the leader of the team. Because he's the one that's out trying to save Celeste, and he's trying to save Tara, and he's always just trying to save everybody. But you're right. After that, it's like, I can respect your hero-ness, but you really need to start pulling your weight in these fights, bro. Because
yeah,
I'm sick,
like,
of saving.
Especially
you.
Early on in the game, it's like you can attack or you can steal. And most item, like, most, like, villains have, like, maybe a potion, maybe an ether, like, not much that you can really steal. So it can really, after that, it just can attack.
Other than the occasional boss where, or the occasional thing where he steals, like, a dope, like, a ribbon or something awesome. Yeah. And the thing about it is, like, I feel like for every one time you steal and get something great, there's 20 times where you steal and get just useless shit.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Or I, like, couldn't steal.
Yeah. Agreed. And then after them, you meet the Edgar and then Sabin, the Figaro brothers. I actually love, I think they're the two, they're my two favorite characters to use in the game. Edgar, dude, in the early going, Edgar's like the royal young king prince of Figaro. He's like the fucking arrogant playboy. In the early going of this game, his tools are useful throughout, like the chainsaw, the drill, and everything. In the early going of this game, that auto crossbow is a godsend.
Dude, because it's like, oh, something that can hit all of the like all the enemies. Perfect.
Yeah, and it does like more damage than most of your normal attacks. And it hits everybody, and it doesn't require MP, so you can use it every turn.
Yeah.
Like, he is so fucking useful in the early going of this game. And then even toward the end of the game, like, you load him up with some of the more powerful items, and like he can hold his own later in the game too, just throwing out damage.
I think Sabin definitely has some of the more useful attacks too.
I agree. To me, he's the ace of my rotation. Like, whenever I play this game, by the end of the game, maybe people that are good at this game know how to do it differently. He's my most powerful character because those blitz moves of his, which are so much easier to put in on the Pixel Remaster than they are in the original version. You put them in like fighting moves. It's like up, down, left, right, A, and you'll do like an attack. And they do a lot of damage. Like, I never use his standard attacks. I'm always using his blitzes. Because sometimes you can hit everybody, you can do the elemental damage, he can heal, it requires no MP. And then what I do with him is I don't put any magic on him for the most part, but I'll throw an Esper on that ups your strength every time you level up. And I just leave it on him and just let him get his strength as high as possible.
Oh yeah, that's a really good way of doing that.
And those two guys, dude, like when you have them both early on in the game, they're both beasts. And to me, there's never a time where they're not worth having in your party. Plus, I like their character. I like the dynamic between the two of them. I like the flashback
because they were
story.
So useful. Like early in the game, I was like, Locke would be like, okay, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
Get out of my sight. I don't want to look at you.
Yeah. No, because you have these two brothers. And then later in the game, when you find out the story about how like Edgar took the throne and Sabin kind of ran off to be his own man and just be his bodybuilding karate guy. And then have you seen the flashback scene where they flip the coin and it's the two-headed coin to decide who's going to take over and who's going to be able to do whatever they want. Like, I love the dynamic between the two of them so much. They're two of my favorite characters in the game. Honestly,
well, there's the whole scene about like, he's like, do you think Dad would be proud of me? And it was like, this is like 1994 video games, like the storytelling in this and like the character building, it's unreal.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. Yeah. It's because like they're these two brothers. And one of them is like, I have the weight of this fucking kingdom on my shoulders, but I'm also, you know, kind of a playboy and kind of like, he tries to be cool, but you can tell he's also scared of all the pressure and everything. And the other one like ran away from the pressure. And now he doesn't know if he's a disappointment to his family. Like I love it. I think they're both easily two of the best characters in the game, Edgar and Sabin. I love them both. You brought up Celeste. I think Celeste is one of the cooler characters in the game as well. I didn't think she'd be as cool as she was. Now, I gotta say, dude, okay, let's spend a minute on that. Everybody fucking praises that opera scene. I have to say, I don't get it. Maybe it's because
really?
I love it. Why does everyone love it so much?
I mean, maybe because I like opera, but okay. Now, my question for you. Did you play the OG or did you play like the Pixel Remaster?
This time I've played both, but this time I played the remaster.
Same. And for this one, the cool thing that they changed is like they actually added lyrics.
Yeah. I think the opera scene is fine. I've just never understood why people are so I'm like, so she like sings an opera. She like pretends to be an opera star and sings an opera to try to lure out this bad guy who has a ship.
Because it's cool. It's never been seen in a game before. Like, it's just this cool like moment. I really enjoy it.
So many do. I know I'm in the vast minority. Maybe it's because I don't like songs and Simpsons. Maybe I'm just that guy. I just don't like it. I don't have a problem with it. I think it's a cool scene. You need to memorize your lines and get them right and like nail it and. I'm assuming everyone that's listening to this has played it or doesn't care about the spoilers, But like Celeste looks a lot like the lead actress in this opera, and you're trying to lure out Setzer, who has a airship, so you can use his airship, and you're and like he'll come.
He is a creepy character, right?
Yes, like, Setzer sucks.
Like he yeah, sucks. Like that's ever since like this is how his character is introduced. Like oh yeah, yeah, he's gonna try to like border like. He's going to just try to sexually assault this opera star. So we're trying to get in on that. It's like, what?
Yeah, yeah. We'll let you take the opera star. Just let us use your car. Because they just want his airship. I think he sucks. And like as a combat guy, I think he sucks. I think the lotto slot thing he has.
Yeah, it's
sucks.
Weird and dumb. He like sucks, I never yeah. use him if I don't he have sucks. To.
Whereas like Celeste, I mean, it's cool that she's like does the opera thing. And I get it. Like it's cool that you have to memorize the lines and shit. I never understood that why it was like so hyped up, but whatever. It is what it is. I think Celeste is one of the.
It's a really cool story moment. It's like a big story moment that.
But
like,
why? She's just pretending to be an opera singer to lure out this weirdo. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm like, my whole life, people have praised the opera scene. And I'm like, why does everybody love this scene?
I guess it's because of the effort that was put into it to creating this opera scene. Because I remember, like, watching the opera scene this time, like, I kind of got the opera. Like, the opera got to me. It was, like, this story about this, you know, this woman. And it, again, like, to be, like, standard opera story. This woman sure. is, like, engaged to be married to this prince who she doesn't love, whereas like the man she does love is she's like waiting for him still. And it kind of like made me go like, oh man, that's so sad. Like it kind of got to me. And like they have like this amazing music that they've written for it, and there's this amazing setup where you're on a castle and like you can see the moon in the background, and I just think it's a fantastic part. Like it's the highlight of the game for me.
And you're not in the minority. You are in the, like, people love that scene. I'm like the fucking bad guy wins. And then we have to start from scratch. And there's this fucking mercenary that works for both the good guys and the bad guys. And then at the end of the game, he decides to help the good guys, but you can't abandon him or he'll fucking die on this thing. And he has a dog. And there's these two brothers that are like estranged and then back together. And one's a king and one's a bodybuilder, but they're awesome. And they're like working together now. And there's this fucking old man with a little girl who paints that might or might not, but probably is the daughter of the fucking mercenary guy with the, I don't know, like, there's so many great things, and everyone just gets excited about this fucking opera that I never get right because I always forget the word. You know how I got it right this time? I took pictures on my phone of what the words were so I could remember them in the opera, because I can't learn my lines and I just don't fucking. I'm not saying it's anyway. The point is, Celeste is a dope character because I love that she's like a general of the empire that they like infused with magic so she could use magic, but then eventually she like turns on the empire and like joins your crew, and then she just becomes, she's to me, like, outside of the Saban and Edgar duo, like, she's my favorite character to use in combat.
Tara. Again, she knows magic like right off the hop,
right? And she can hold her own with a sword, like she kind of does both. And then she's also got that runic ability that I've seen some people call useless. I think that runic ability is fucking awesome. She can, like, if you use runic, she doesn't do anything else. But if the enemy uses an attack spell, she just absorbs it and you don't take any damage. It's fucking awesome.
I guess that's cool, but, like, also, you could have just used cure during that move.
Yeah, but, like, she's over there just absorbing the... There's two or three fights, like, some tough fights in this game where if I have her and she can use runic and I get runic off in time that she's using it properly... I'm like, I don't even have to cure because the enemy's not even going to touch me because Celeste has got defense. The rest of us can just go.
I'll be honest. Every time I used runic was by accident.
I loved it. I love runic. It seems to be divisive. Some people love it and some hate it. I loved it. But either I think the point at the end of the day, whether you, because you like her as an opera singer or her abilities, everybody can agree that Celeste is one of the better characters in the game.
Yes.
She's awesome. Yeah, Celeste is dope. Cyan, I think is how you say it. He's like the old... Samurai.
Now, he was one of my favorite party members, not just for like his tragic story, but like, dude, fuck shit up.
So when you get him, yeah, like his tragic story is he's at that castle that Kefka poisons the water in, and his wife and kid get killed, and everybody else there dies too. And I love his interactions with, like, especially with Gao, but then like the way he's like so polite to everybody and he's like so out of touch with everybody. In the early going, I find him very useful as just like an attacker. later in the game, the only problem I had with him later in the game was that the only way I really found him useful was his ability, that Bushida ability, where you had to like charge up his big attacks. And I just found they took a long time to get built up to, like the good ones. But he's definitely
like the attack he has where he'll attack everybody like one at a time.
Yeah, yeah.
And it'll always be random who he attacks, but it is a kind of a good like attack all type attack.
The only thing I found with Cyan is toward the end of the game, I find that like, well, I have Sabin and Edgar to do just straight up physical damage, and I've got like three or four better music or magic users, and I've got Shadow that can throw stuff. And so he's like, when I go into like that final tower, of course he's coming and I'm leveling him up. But I'm slotting him in like right around the middle of the pack for that fight against Kefka, because he's not one of the guys I need right away type thing.
Okay. Like,
you know what I mean? But he's like, to me, he's like just above the top half of the usable characters in fight. But I think he's one of the nicer. He just seems like such a nice character. Like, he just seems like a nice guy. I like him.
Such a pleasant fellow. I would have tea with him.
He just seems like a pleasant fellow. Dude, in the Dark World, when he's like sending letters and shit to that girl pretending to be somebody else just to make her feel better.
Like the carrier pigeons.
Yeah, I like it. I thought that was nice. I like him. He's nice. And he's got a great mustache. Great mustache. Shadow, we already mentioned. I think Shadow is like he's like an assassin. He's a mercenary. I love that it sometimes he works with you. Sometimes he actually works with the Empire. I think he's fucking awesome. I think he's fairly useful in combat because he evades a lot, and I love his throw ability. You stock up on like ninja stars and those scrolls and shit. He can do a lot of damage, man, in those fights. I just think he's like the coolest character. He's got his own fucking music. Like, he's the coolest character. I think, anyways.
Yeah, like he's a cool character.
And it's almost a
Gao
meme,
I don't like. Gao is a character I was never huge on.
No, sorry, just before we move on, I just wanted to say a meme in Final Fantasy VI is don't forget Shadow. I think it's such an awesome but frustrating thing that you have him up there on that floating island, and if you don't wait till the last couple of seconds to leave, you leave him behind and you can't use him anymore. Like, I think that's so cool, but it's also so frustrating if you don't know.
Oh, shit, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know
that. Why, did you leave him? Did you leave him?
No.
No, you brought him with you?
No, I brought him with me, absolutely. Okay. I didn't know that if you left him there, you couldn't get him again.
Yeah, if you bail on the island without him getting onto the boat, he's gone. You don't get him back.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, it's crazy. But I think that's so cool, albeit frustrating because he's a cool character to lose. But that's it. Yeah, Gao, I don't know, dude. I think Gao's like a neat story that he's like this little kid that was abandoned by his family and lives out in the field like learning of attacks from enemies. But I've never liked the blue mages in games, the ones that learn their abilities from the other, from the enemies. And Gao's no different. I have no patience for him. I never use him.
No, and like, it's always so random, whatever he chooses to do. Like, you can't really strategize with him because it's just like, okay, well, he's just going to do random attacks from this enemy.
Yeah. Well, and like, and what I find frustrating with him too is when you're in combat, unless there's something I don't know, I don't know how to see what his abilities do. Like,
no,
so like when
neither.
You go to, right. So you pick one of his attacks, but I'm like, I don't know what this attack does. And then if I pick the wrong one, now he could be fucking me over and helping the enemy for the rest of the battle. Like, I've read that, like, if you really put time into using him and everything, he could become OP as fuck. I will never have the patience to learn how to use him properly.
No, life's never. Too short to learn how to use Gao.
But I think he's got a cool story of like being the abandoned kid and everything. Like, I love his
kid roaming the plane, being friends with monsters and stuff. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. And I love watching him interact with Cyan and how much he drives him crazy sometimes. Like, he's a fun character. I just wish that he wasn't so hard to use.
Yes, exactly.
That's all. Yeah. Setzer, the gambler we already got into, he fucking sucks. I don't like him.
He sucks. He's creepy. He's got the flying ship, which is nice, but like, other than that, there's no real point to him in the story.
No, you're just using him for his car, his flying boat, his flying boat.
Yeah, he's the Kanicki of the story.
Yeah. Strago, the like old man. I like him as a character. I think he's neat. He's like Realm's grandpa, I think, or she calls him Grandpa anyway. I don't know if he actually is Grandpa or not, but that's like what, how she like refers to him. I think he's like a, does, I think she does, doesn't she? Does she call him Grandpa?
I think so.
Yeah, yeah.
Or Gramps, like, or something, yeah, along, yeah, those lines. I mean, I also got the impression that that was her grandpa.
Right. Which, like, I don't know, because, like, and again, I'm not, like, the one thing that makes me nervous about covering this game is anything we get wrong, I'm going to hear about 400 times. So just, if I get some lore wrong, you can write in if you, like, tell me, but, like, I'm also, like, just know that, like, they're minor. I don't care. Like, you can tell me, I'm not trying to be rude, but it's just like, it's because I get it. Cause I'm passionate about stuff too. I get it. But like, I'm nervous that I'm going to be like, oh, he's actually not her grandpa. She just calls him that. It's like, I believe that she, Realm, is Shadow's daughter. I think you find that out later in the game. They never actually say it, I don't think, but they imply it. And in like a hidden scene. And so I'm like, so does that mean that Strago is like his dad?
I don't know. Yeah. Like, I don't know. I never got that scene, so I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. But anyways, like, the point is, Strago, like, he should be like the old mage, and he's got those like lore abilities or whatever that he can use, like certain magic and stuff. But I find him like Gao. I just find him very, I don't use him very much. I find him very frustrating to use.
I don't know. I find the attacks he does have were very useful in that one boss fight against like the fire monsters.
Yeah. Yeah.
But like, yeah, you're right. Like, overall, like, nothing particularly special about him.
No, I do like that when the world goes dark, you find him like in the cult outside of Kefka's tower because he's just given up. I thought that was very cool. Like, I thought that was a nice touch. But other than that, yeah, I don't find him that useful. And then Realm, the little girl, his granddaughter or whatever. The first couple times I played this, I never really used her because she's got that ability where she can like paint the enemies and like use their like, and I never really understood what to do with her. But this time around, I tried using her a bit, and like, she's a beast. If you just give her some magic and stick her in the back row, she's a beast of a magic user. I don't know. Do you use her at all?
I never used her. I did find the one thing, in the one Ultima boss fight, very amusing, where she just drew him and he was like, oh my God, is that what I look like? And then that's how you win the fight. And it's like, well, that's really kind of funny, actually.
Quick shout out to Ultros, that purple squid.
Yeah.
He's fucking funny, man. He's hilarious.
Really goofy reoccurring boss. Who's like, I get like, Kefka's the star of the show for sure when it comes to villains, but like, man, is like a B-side villain, like really, really just like really good stuff.
Yeah, every time he pops up, you get excited because he's funny. That part where you're in the airship and you see him in the background, or like when he pops up in the opera house in the back, it's like, fucking just go away. And you just keep fighting him and he keeps losing.
Fucking fight against him in the airship, though. I kept getting rocked at that.
Oh, really? Yeah, where he's got that creature with him, that big pink thing.
Yeah. That he was just like, I met this guy when I was sleeping the other day or something.
Yeah, he's awesome. Every time he pops up, it makes me happy. I think one of the issues with Strago and Realm for me is that you just get them so late in the game. Like, I just don't have the attachment to them that I do the other characters, you know? Like, I wish you got them a little
earlier. I feel about a lot of JRPGs. Like, they will they'll keep adding characters and adding characters. And then, like... the last few characters that you get, you're just like, man, but I've built my team. Like, okay, I'm sure you guys are great, but like,
yeah,
I've already grown attached to these other characters in the team.
Yeah, agreed. So then there's Mog, who's just like a Moogle. I really don't care about his story at all, but like, I don't know. Does anyone not like Moogles? Like, they're cool.
Yeah, Moogles are cute.
And he's actually pretty useful in this game too. I actually quite enjoy using him. He's fairly powerful. He's usually one of like, he's like, I usually have like a, so like when you go into Kefka's tower and you need to build the three teams, like you need a couple of anchors on each team. And he's like a secondary anchor for me. I kind of use him like a dragoon and I find him pretty useful.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely this time around was like more, late game addition, but like found him pretty strong. Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's Go-Go.
And I do like the Yeti. For all of the shit you're talking, I like the Yeti.
Umaro, the stupid Yeti. So there's two characters that are optional. He's one. And he's useless. Like, when you put him in fights, he just kind of does his... Apparently, he's super strong, but I never use him. The only time I ever use him is in the Colosseum, because he's so powerful and he doesn't have a bunch of other moves to fuck everything up with. But I just find him... I don't like him. Like, do you use him?
I did at the end.
Ugh.
Like, it was never, like, in the main team, but, like, at the end of the game was, like, useful to have him.
I never bring him, and I never bring Go-Go. Those are always the two I leave behind.
I did get Go-Go. What is Go-Go's deal?
He's like, he mimics. So you can, like, play with them, and, like, actually, he can get powerful if you fuck around with him enough, because you can basically give him, like, other people's abilities and kind of make him whatever you want him to be.
Well, it's the same as Gao, though. Like...
No. But like Go-Go uses like your abilities.
Oh.
Gao learns them like from the other bad guys.
That makes sense.
Yeah. But I just, to me, he's got like no story. He's a stupid character. I don't like his name.
It's kind of like, if we're talking like a Pokemon comparison, it's like Ditto. And it's like, what's the point of this character? Like,
yeah.
It sounds useful on paper, but if you think about it, it's a really fucking stupid character, because if you throw out a Ditto against, say, like a Charizard or something, you need one turn to turn Ditto into a Charizard, and then even then, like, you're one turn behind and you're fighting Charizard against Charizard.
Yeah. But like, what we like, so the, like, you all just listen to us for like 20 minutes break down the roster from this game, and that to me is if the enemy, if the villain and the story are all great, another thing that's just as good as those is the fact that you've got these 14 characters that all have different abilities and everything, and most of them have at least half decent, interesting stories. And you can mix and match your parties however you want. And again, when you go into the final dungeon of this game, you have to build three teams of up to four people each and control them all separately. So you can mix and match however you want. You can load a team with all attackers, but they've got no way to heal. I just think it's such a masterclass in like party customization that you can do whatever you want with these guys. And that each one, like, they're not just, oh, these three all attack, these three all use magic. Like, you can basically do whatever you want with them. And as we got to get ready to wrap this up soon, I want to talk about the Esper system, because I think that's the secret sauce on this whole thing. That's a delicious, delicious burger. Fairly early in the game, you get the ability to start attaching these mystic, they're basically summons, these espers, these magical creatures in their magicite forms, which are like crystallized forms of these creatures, to characters. And then as you battle, they learn magic spells. So then most of your characters can learn magic. And then you can do whatever the fuck you want. You could make Sabin, to me, is one of the most powerful guys in the game. He's the martial arts guy. If you want to, you can make him a white mage. Just give him all these, let him learn every white magic spell in the game.
And that to me is what finally made like Locke useful. Because like, yeah, most of the game, he's useless. Like, not somebody you want in your party. And when you have to have him in your party, you're like, okay, I guess, but I better have somebody else who can like actually fuck shit up. And so, but by the end of the game, Locke can be a useful character.
I genuinely think, and that's another reason I don't like the Yeti, is because he can't learn magic. And I'm like, that's one of the things I like, is that I can, like, one of the first things I do is I make sure everybody in any of my parties knows like basic white magic, so that even between battles, like, I never use Sabin's magic in fights, but between battles, he's just got this fucking pool of MP that he doesn't use for anything else. So he's my healer between battles.
Yeah, and that's smart.
You know? Yeah. And I love that you can do that kind of stuff. And then, like we said, you're not just teaching the magic spells, but a lot of those espers come with like stat boosts, like strength plus two or 10% HP. So whenever they level up, their stats are boosting. So if you want to sit down and take the time to grind it out, you can basically build any character into just about anything you want them to be. I love that. I love that customizability, because it's not forced on you. Each character's got a role, and if you just play the game by the book, they'll all reach their potential in those roles. But if you want to get funky and start tweaking everybody, then you've got the option to do that. And I just think that's so magnificently done.
And the one thing I also really do like about this game is you don't have to, like, there's a little bit of grinding you have to do here and there, but it's not a lot. Like, the game kind of does level up with you.
Yeah, like, I think when you, I don't know exactly how it works, but when you are reuniting your team in the Dark World, I think they come in, like when you find them, they're like an average of your party's level or something. So like I didn't often find myself with a bunch of people like, because again, that's what stresses me out when I have a big party, a big group of people, is I don't know who to use and who to level up and shit. Nobody feels horribly left behind in this game.
Yes,
by
exactly.
Levels and stuff. So you because don't.
Because yeah. It is like that, where it does like level it up for you a little bit as well. Because yeah. Again, like first half of this game, I didn't use lock if I didn't have to.
Sure.
And so that time jump actually like helps significantly.
Yeah. No, I just think I have so many nice things to say about it. The storytelling is great. The characters are great. The customizability of all the characters is great. All their different abilities is awesome. I love that there's like secret stuff. Like there's the quest where you can go and fight the dragons in the Dark World and go find all of them if you want. There's the Colosseum. The more you explore, the more backstory you find out about these characters. It's just such a fucking well-made video game. Have you got any, before we kind of get ready? Oh, and the soundtrack slaps. Like, I don't know how else to say.
Great, yes.
Yeah, soundtrack is really good.
Especially the opera scene.
Oh, fuck. Shadows theme, damn it. Is there anything you don't like that we haven't covered?
Random encounters. That's the one thing that I thought Chrono Trigger came along and like kind of fixed that was still present in this game is like, it makes, I found like, especially when you're like exploring a place like Zozo, like it makes exploration difficult if you know that like every random step you can be attacked without warning.
Zozo is my least favorite part of the game.
Zozo's the place where I've given up on a few runs of this game.
Yeah, it's like as soon as I go into that town, I'm like, this is my least favorite part of this game. Every fucking time. And like in Final Fantasy IV, I hate the temple where you can't use metal weapons. And in Final Fantasy VI, to me, that temple is Zozo. Fucking hate it. So I'll give you that. The random encounters I don't like, but I didn't find them as overbearing in this game as I have in some other ones. But I still, and I think it's just because I like the way that all my, like, I never feel like a battle is a waste of time because at least I'm like, oh, I might learn some new magic or, you know, maybe save
the level or whatever. Yeah.
But I agree though. Like just generally like random encounters irritate me very much. So I agree with that. Like I won't not get a point for it or anything, but if I had my way, there would be no random encounters.
Yeah, exactly.
Other than that though, dude, like I really don't have anything else to complain about. I just think this is a insanely well-made video game. Like it's just very,
like really, I think really that good. Yeah, my biggest complaint is the random encounters, which I think you don't see much in games anymore.
No.
Because it's annoying, but like yeah, overall like the story is a 10, the characters are a 10, like the gameplay is fantastically fun. Like it is the best Final Fantasy game.
It's very hard to argue against it. Like I'll hear arguments. I think there are a couple, but like I can't see anybody being like, no, that's how the fuck could you say that's the best? I'm like, it's one of the best RPGs ever made. It's one of the best Final Fantasies. It's one of the best Super Nintendo games. It has no major flaws. It's just, and I'm sure we've missed some stuff. I'm sure I'll get messages being like, you guys forgot that you can escape the dungeon without using the wizard's key or whatever the fuck the line is. But it's just a great. I'm out of stuff. I'm done. I'm just gushing. It's just a fucking. If by some fluke you listen to this episode, and you haven't played it, please play it. Like the only reason to me not to is if you despise JRPGs.
But if you're a JRPG fan, like especially if you love games like Earthbound or Chrono Trigger, this is a must play.
Yeah, I can't even imagine to me, it's if you are a JRPG fan, this is, that'd be like, I'm a platforming fan. I've never played Super Mario World.
Exactly.
Like this is an essential play for a JRPG fan. Essential play. We got to score it, Mark. Darth had recommended a score of 14 as there were 14 playable characters.
Okay.
So out of 14, what are you going to give Final Fantasy VI?
I'll give it 12. Knock off 2 for the random encounters.
That's fair. I'm a bit conflicted. I'm like, can I? I've been honestly trying to decide, like, can I give it a perfect score? I think, I don't think I can, but I don't think it really does anything wrong. I'm going to give it 13. Like, I think it's just, I just think it's great. I really have no major qualms. I had so much fun replaying. I think this recent playthrough I just did was the most fun I've ever had playing it.
Yeah, like, me too, especially with this Pixel remaster.
Yeah, and it's such a great game, portable, and it's just such a great game. I would love to see this game done in the Final Fantasy VII remake style.
Oh my god, like, yeah, absolutely.
I don't think we'll get it, but god, that would make me happy. Oh,
me too.
God. Anyway, good shit. That was fun. Man, that hour like flew by. I know we were kind of all over the map. I hope that we stayed at least semi on point for all of you. And I hope you all enjoyed this episode as much as I did. Mark, I hope you enjoyed this as much as I did.
I did, yeah.
And buddy, welcome back to Remember the Game. Good to have you on the OG show again. Yeah. You're still not in the hall though. You're still banned.
One day.
No. Mario's missing. Fucked you forever, sir. I don't give a fuck how good your soundtrack is. You can go listen to opera and play Mario is Missing then, you son of a bitch. Good shit. Buddy, thanks for doing this. And I guess I'll talk to you in a couple of days when we record our next Purple Monkey Dishwasher.
Yeah, I'll talk to you soon, Adam.
Boom. And that's going to do it for this week's episode. Darth Skywalter, thank you so much for your generosity, for sponsoring this episode and getting me to replay one of the greatest games of all time. And to my former Hall of Fame friend, Mark McHugh, thank you for wandering out of the seedy underbelly of Purple Monkey Dishwasher to come back to an episode of Remember the Game. I appreciate you, buddy. And most importantly, I guess, thank you to all of you for listening to this stupid show, because whether this was your first time at Remember the Game or your 262nd, I sure appreciate the support more than you could ever imagine. And if you didn't hate it, maybe leave us a good review somewhere, would you? I don't know what they accomplished, but all the good shows ask for them, so I'm going to ask for them too. And when I'm feeling blue, I read the reviews, and the good ones make me feel better, and I pleasure myself to the bad ones, because I love haters' tears. But I prefer a good review. Just for the record, I have lots of things to pleasure myself to. I prefer the good review. If you want more of these, patreon.com/rememberthegame. There is like, I think it's close to 500 bonus podcasts waiting for you. And we drop 4 new episodes a week, all ad-free. Fucking awesome. And like I said, you can finally get them on Spotify. On Spotify, if you look for Remember the Game Patreon feed, you should be able to find it on there. You can go through the entire catalog, see what you're missing. I am going to get that link up on rememberthegamepodcast.com in the next couple of days, too, so you can find it there. If you want to, I sure would appreciate the support. Subscription start at $3 a month to get all the perks, blah, 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 blah. I'm on Twitch whenever you want to come by and see me, whenever I want to get on there and see you, twitch.tv/rememberthegame. And I have a P.O. box. You can find it at rememberthegamepodcast.com. Shoot me a letter. Let me know where you're listening. I'll send you one back. We will be friends. And while you're at rememberthegamepodcast.com, don't forget to check out our merch, because we're running a summer sale that's going to go until the end of September now. You can save 20% on all Remember the Game merch, including our 2 new 5th anniversary shirt designs. Rememberthegamepodcast.com. Is that everything I want to plug, Molly? Yeah, I think that's it. I'll be back tomorrow with Expansion Pass 176, Game Patch on Friday, and then next week, a whole nother slab of these stupid podcasts, including Remember the Game 263, which, assuming everything works out, will be about Silent Hill for the PlayStation 1. Should be a doozy. I was going to like a gooder or a doozy? A goozy. Whatever. I'm going to thank some patrons and get out of here. Thanks for listening, everybody. Talk to you on the next one. Cheers. So long. Goodbye. Yeah. Remember the Game is brought to you by our Patreons. I could not puke up all the content I turn out every week without all of your support. The following people are the senior executive vice president level, and I'd like to take a moment to thank them all, and sincerely and quickly as possible, as I'm contractually obligated to do. And also, you can hear the opera music playing below me. We're trying to get through this whole thing before the opera ends, so a huge thank you to Nation Mellow, Magic Money, Joe Buck, Sharonic, Andre, The Keegs, James Clark, Dave McGee, Dan of DNA Gaming, Slick Rick, Doug Dorn, Chris Fleury, Andrew Wright, Jordan, Fraser Burns, Angry Ticks, Dave Thompson, No One Cares, Scott Brooks, Aaron Lawson, Nathan Trombley, A-Town, Morgan, Zane Donovan, Ryan Kinchin, Mike Maloney, G9PSX, Mercury869, Wolfgang, Darren, Andy Hudson, Doogie, Wolfmagic21, Johnny from Virginia, Squints, Titan420, Zonko504, Jeff Bergeron, Captain N, Daniel, Tutable Power, John Woodruff, Sir Francis Cake, Just a Fish, Trevor Leahy, Denzalo, Holmes, Zach Shepard, Ballsack, T-Bagger, Chris Dick and Frosty, V492, Triple, Chugger22, Elijah Burns, it's the nerd, it's that nerd James, Ray San Wantonga, Nova Crane, DBXJ, Jameer Williams, Steve Dalk, Mizuru, Juris Dr. Mario, Phil Lencher, Joe the Sandman, Ruben Elizald, Eric James, Nick Amos, Jake Carter, Thomas Childs, Biddy Laces Out Dan, Beaver Boy, C-Spin, Thomas Smith, Nicola, Leroy Restwich, Leroy Westrich, Evolva, Sean Ramos, Studstill, Smash, Matt Babinude, Gabe, Dan Fusselman, Fuzzy99, Decoy Man, a dude named Adam, Wyatt the Surgeon who's not a surgeon, Roblane, the Hoagie Man, Scary Terry, Storm Beagle, Antonio Echeverria, Hega Waffle, High Plains Drifter, Esteban Navarro, KH, Timothy Joe Stone, Chris Williams, Oroku Saki's Gardener, Scrub Tech 84, Nicole Aldena, Cody Richardson, General Furry, and Boys on the Roof, Max Lagroom, James on Francesco, John of the Adult Children Podcast, Franklin Badge, Drugs of Bed, okay, Sam Carpenter, Donnie the Dude, Walter, Nerdy Hybrid, The Fletchman, Colin Bollinger, Sleeper Hit, Squeak Nuts, Isaias, Timmy the Exuberant, Turtle, Brian Neese, Christian Gabriel, Maverick Marty, Radioactive Man, Musty Beetle, Graham Kennedy, On My Foot, John M. Watkins, Timothy Sabrinsky, Beef Dingleberry, Hitchy Poo, Len, Bulmasim, Chevy Boy 9211, Trevor McKee, Burt Macklin, Quiet Place Queen, Cam Nelly 23, Christopher Britt, Zamatos, Big the Cat, Oh My God, It Froze, Bobby Litton, Brandon DeZeba, Kia Puff, Knife Goes and Guts Come Out, AB Killen Works For Me, Dakota Guy, Alexander Camps, Neil Cooper, Tom Houlihan, Ted Explosion, Ryan Perry, Alex R, It's the Bigfoot, Itchy Nutsuru, Mr. Papa Giorgio, Just Car Prank, Solomon Soto, Darth Skywalter, Postman, WestGen, Nick Creature, Adam Arnett, Nafi, The Big Deal, Dr. Nightmare 23, Kevin Monroe, Can't Destroy Her, Shorzy, Beers of War, Because 19, Digital Dave, Lord Longrod, Von Hugend on the Second, Brian Weber, Frosty Bear, Max Sandin, Sour Goatface, Alex Ramos, Faded Sufferance, Benjamin Atkins, Mellow Yellow 8787, B Money, Hire Goons, Who, It's OG, Tyler Bauer, Fallen Snow Kiku, The Supreme, Chose Arizo, E-Man, Trucker, Mark Sneed, That One Kid, Josh, Raging Irish, Atrio, Wormwood, Shoeboxers, Adam Black, Steelers Review, Mario Galaxy, Jake Callahan, Robbie Air, Guy Who Does Things, Sabin, Brian Richmond, Blobby Rogers, Super Nintendo Chalmers, Glooscap, and Bula, Adam Blank's Evil Twin, Matt Zeus, Buy Me Bone Storm, Plow King, Cesar, Filling My Mouth with Farts, Liquor Like Luigi, Cody Thompson, Preston Dylan Tourette, Swallow My Own Spit Here, Uncanny, Elephant Calf, Scissor Fist, Big Daddy, Randall, Ryan Whitcomb, Flinny123, Austin from the Past, The Present Player Podcast, Lord Stay Puffed, Johnny Zubu 81, AJ Mukherjee, fuck that one, fucks with me every time, FR Philip Ramsey, Nothing Could Possibly Go Wrong, Alex McIntyre, Bearded Bastard, and Eric Hopewell. I won't know if I made it to the end of the opera or not before I edit this, but it looks like it's going to be close. I hope I did. I should probably just shut up and get out of here. Thanks, everybody. Talk to you in the next one. Cheers.